has arrived in the meeting hall.
Order. I now declare open the 62nd annual session of the NATO Parliamentary Assembly. Would everyone please take their seats? I would like to welcome you all to this plenary session of our assembly here in Istanbul. I would like to thank the head of the Turkish delegation, Mr. Osman Bak, for hosting the session and for the great welcome he and the other members of the Turkish delegation have extended to the Assembly. We have a number of distinguished speakers addressing the Assembly today, and I would like to take this opportunity to welcome others who are present. I welcome Mr. Ahmet Aydin, Deputy Speaker of the Turkish Grand National Assembly. Mr. Aydin, on behalf of our Assembly, I would like to thank you for hosting the splendid reception last night. I would also welcome the Turkish Minister of Foreign Affairs and the Minister of National Defense to our proceedings. We also have with us Mr. Andrei Perubi, Speaker of the Ukrainian Parliament. Mr. Perubi, I am very pleased that you can be with us once again. Before we move on to our main business, I would like to convey a tribute to Jose Lelo. Jose passed away on October 14, 2016. He was one of the leading figures who steered the Assembly through the transformative years of the Cold War. As the Assembly's president in 2007 and 2008. He shaped the Assembly's response to Russia's war against Georgia, leading a high-level NATO PA delegation visit to the contact line just days into Russia's aggression. Following the end of his presidential term, Jose remained actively engaged in our work, serving as the chairman of the NATO PA's political committee between 2013 and 2015. We remember Jose as a good friend, an outstanding political colleague, and one of the leading voices of the Assembly. I therefore invite the Assembly to join me in a 1 minute silence in his memory. Please stand. try again. Good morning. 2 years ago, this assembly entrusted me with the responsibility to serve as its president and carry forward our important mission to provide an indispensable parliamentary forum underpinning our unique transatlantic alliance. I truly believe that we are all better parliamentarians and legislators as a result of the information that we receive at these meetings and as a result of our shared dialogue that permits each of us to better understand the issues that we are jointly facing and our varied perspectives on these issues. I took office as the world was still reeling from the profound shocks of 2014. Russia had invaded and annexed Crimea in less than a month, in flagrant violation of its international obligations. For the first time in over 70 years, a European nation was seeking to withdraw borders by force. Meanwhile, Moscow sent its army to sow chaos in eastern Ukraine, hoping that the world would be fooled by its tale of a local and spontaneous separatist uprising. At their summit meeting in Wales in September 2014, NATO heads of state and government had taken bold steps to respond and adapt to this profoundly new environment. These challenges remain as real and present today as they were 2 years ago. Russia has consolidated its military presence in Crimea with 40,000 troops deployed on and around the peninsula, a modernized Black Sea fleet, and advanced air defense systems. In Syria, Russia continues its assault in support of Bashar al-Assad and is using the same indiscriminate tactics which have led to the death of hundreds of thousands of Syrians since the beginning of the conflict. And it prevents a peaceful settlement. In Syria, we also continue to face the terrorist organization Daesh. Daesh holds ground in Iraq and Syria, and its malicious ideology has resulted in terrorist atrocities in our own cities. Daesh is also establishing new strongholds in Yemen, Libya, and Afghanistan. The conflict in Syria and the presence of Daesh has resulted in a humanitarian and refugee crisis for NATO allies and our partners. NATO has risen to these challenges. In just 2 years, the alliance has gone through an extensive transformation and launched further important measures at the summit of NATO heads of state and government this summer in Warsaw. NATO allies have contributed to deployments and exercises aimed at reassuring those nations bordering Russia. NATO has established 8 small headquarters along its eastern flank, tripled the size of its rapid response force, and created a spearhead force able to deploy within days. In Warsaw, Allied leaders announced the deployment in 2017 of 4 multinational battalions in the Baltic states and in Poland, and the activation of a multinational brigade in Romania. Furthermore, they revised NATO's nuclear posture to respond to Moscow's open nuclear threats. In Warsaw, NATO took additional steps to address security threats emanating from its southern flank. We have expanded our mission to train Iraqi security personnel. NATO is now providing aerial surveillance to the international coalition fighting Daesh. We have also enhanced our maritime counterterrorism missions in the Mediterranean, working hand in hand with our EU partners. Last but not least, allies have demonstrated that they are prepared to underwrite this transformation by allocating more resources to their defense. Our assembly supported many of these measures from the very beginning and restated them in a resolution we passed at our spring session in Tirana. I was honored to present our recommendations to the Allied heads of state and government in Warsaw. However, I remain convinced that we should go farther. During my term as president, we set 3 priorities. First, to give ourselves the means to deter Russia. In other words, ensuring Russia's threats and intimidation would be met with a united front, so that it would never have cause to believe that it could act on those threats with impunity. I have published for this session a report entitled Deterring to Defend, NATO After the Warsaw Summit, calling on NATO to reaffirm our deterrence mission. We must further strengthen NATO's deterrent by increasing the number of NATO troops deployed in the Baltic states, Poland, and Romania, pre-positioning more equipment and investing in the infrastructure that will enable and accelerate reinforcements. Our second priority was to stress the importance of reinvesting in our defense and better share the burden among us. Or put differently, demonstrating our transatlantic solidarity, not just in words, but in deeds. We must also continue to reverse past cuts in our defense budgets and to reduce imbalances between allies. And we must invest in the core and new capabilities which will ensure that NATO remains an unrivaled military with a technological edge. Thirdly, to show that NATO's door is truly open, we must make the prospect of NATO membership a reality for aspirants. We must not only welcome Montenegro as the alliance 29th member state, we must also keep the door open to all aspirants and others as well. Our host for this meeting, Turkey, stands in the front line of many of the challenges NATO faces today, and it is playing its full part in addressing them by contributing to the defense of other allies in the Black Sea, by projecting stability from the Mediterranean and the Western Balkans to Afghanistan, as well as providing shelter for millions of refugees on its own land. But Turkey is also a good example of how allied solidarity works both ways. NATO allies have deployed air defense and surveillance systems at Turkey's request to assist with defending its southern border. Allies have also stood with Turkey against terrorism. This beautiful city of Istanbul has lost hundreds of its sons and daughters at the hands of terrorist fanatics. I would like to restate here our firm condemnation of terrorism in all of its manifestations. There is no lesser or acceptable form of terrorism. Every life lost to terrorism is a tragedy. And I would like to extend our heartfelt condolences to all of the victims of terrorism in Turkey and in all of our countries. 4 months ago, on July 15th, Turkey suffered another form of assault. I know, Turkey's many friends here all know, the trauma that the attempted coup constituted for this country. Some 300 people were killed that night in an attack led by members of the institutions that were sworn to protect them. And we know that it was thanks to the courage and resolve of the Turkish people that the coup attempt was thwarted. In my own country, there was an immediate expression of support for Turkey. Secretary Kerry issued a statement on July 15, 2016, and indicated his full support for the democratically elected civilian institutions of Turkey, and reported that he had spoken by telephone to Turkey's foreign minister. On the morning of July 16th, the President of the United States issued a statement in full support of Turkey and called for the rule of law to avoid any additional violence or instability. The Speaker of the United States House of Representatives additionally expressed his support for Turkey, and as President of the NATO Parliamentary Assembly, I issued a statement on behalf of all of the delegates of our Assembly in support of Turkey's democratic institutions and people on July 16th. President-elect Paolo Ali and Secretary General David Hobbs conveyed their support in person when they attended the Democracy and Solidarity Summit hosted by Speaker Karaman in September. This session here in Istanbul also shows our solidarity with Turkey and the Turkish people, and is also an important opportunity to restate our support for Turkey's democracy. Solidarity and democracy go hand in hand. NATO is the most successful alliance in history because it is united in its belief in and commitment to our shared values. As members of this alliance, it is the duty of each and every one of our nations to protect these values and to defend each other. President Erdogan, in addition to our support for Turkey, our sessions here in Istanbul have also included a discussion of the concerns of our members that the unfolding events challenge the democratic institutions in Turkey and the application of the rule of law. We thank you for providing your ministers of justice and foreign affairs and the chief staff of the Ministry of Defense to answer questions of our members. I also wish to commend Osman Bak for his diligence and hard work during this assembly, answering both privately and publicly the questions of our members concerning the emergency measures being undertaken in Turkey. Mr. President, based upon these presentations, my colleagues and I understand that actions being taken against individuals are to be based on a judicial process. And during this session, our members have voiced their continued concern that these judicial proceedings be based upon public and clear evidentiary findings. President Erdogan, it is also my understanding that you have spoken with United States President-elect Donald Trump, and that your subsequent statements indicated a commitment from Mr. Trump and yourself to strengthen our country's relations. I and the entire United States delegation support that effort. Let me now turn to another aspect of alliance solidarity, the transatlantic bond, which is at the heart of our alliance. Throughout my presidency, I have done my utmost to keep our transatlantic relationship strong. Several of you have accompanied me to Capitol Hill to advocate for a strong U.S.-NATO alliance. This effort, which began under my predecessor, Hugh Bailey, has resulted in a new appreciation of NATO for my U.S. colleagues. Over the past 4 years, we have met key leaders of the House majority, the leadership of the Foreign Affairs and Armed Services Committee, some of the most ardent supporters of NATO, as well as some of the leading skeptics. With all of them, we shared our conviction that Europe and North America are and remain each other's closest and most dependable allies, that our centuries-old transatlantic bond is unique, and that NATO embodies our exceptional pledge to defend each other and uphold our common values. I will continue to make the case for NATO in the United States, as will your friends in the United States delegation, but we will only succeed if we can count on all of you to do the same within your own governments and constituencies. As my presidency draws to a close today, I take comfort in the knowledge that members of this assembly understand the scale of our challenges. I have every confidence that my successor will be a tireless advocate for NATO and for our transatlantic bond, and I stand ready to assist in any way I can. I want to thank you all again for the privilege of serving as your president. It has been a real honor to represent all of you and this great organization. Our work continues, and I am sure I speak on behalf of all of my colleagues from the United States delegation when I say that we will continue to play our part. Thank you. It is now my pleasure to welcome the President of the Republic of Turkey, Mr. Erdogan. Mr. President, let me stress once again for the record our appreciation for Turkey's commitment to NATO and its contribution to our collective security and for the incredible job that Turkey has done in hosting this session. Mr. President, you now have the floor.
Sayın Başkan, kıymetli misafirler, saygıdeğer parlamenterler, hanımefendiler, beyefendiler, sizleri sevgiyle, saygıyla selamlıyorum. NATO Parlamenterler Asamblesi 62. yıllık genel kurul toplantısı vesilesiyle sizleri ülkemizde ağırlamaktan duyduğum memnuniyeti bir kez daha ifade ediyorum. Türkiye'ye kıtaların ve medeniyetlerin buluştuğu bu güzel şehre, İstanbul'umuza hoş geldiniz. Kapanış oturumunu gerçekleştirdiğimiz toplantının ülkelerimiz, bölgemiz ve tüm insanlık için barış, huzur ve işbirliğine vesile olmasını diliyorum. Değerli misafirler, küresel boyutta yepyeni sınamalar ve tehditlerle karşı karşıya bulunuyoruz. Terör ve iklim değişikliği bunların başında geliyor. Yabancı düşmanlığı ve hatta sonuçları itibariyle İslam düşmanlığı belirli ülkelerin sınırlarını aşan bir niteliğe bürünmüş durumda. Günümüz dünyasında hiçbirimiz bir yangın çıktığında Nasıl olsa dumanı ve ateşi bana gelmez diyemeyiz. Böyle bir şansımız yok. Er ya da geç bu yangın, bu duman bize de ulaşacaktır. Tehditlerin küreselleştiği ve güç dengelerinin değiştiği böyle bir dönemde mevcut kurumların da kendilerini gözden geçirmeleri şarttır. Bu tehditlerin bertaraf edilmesi ve fırsatların kazanımlara çevrilebilmesi için meselelerin daha kapsayıcı platformlarda ele alınması gerekiyor. NATO Parlamenterler Asamblesi, parlamenter diplomasinin kurumsallaşması bir yapısı olarak 60 yılı aşkın bir süredir bu amaçla faaliyet gösteriyor. NATO'pa ülkelerinin parlamenterleri arasında sürdürülen istişareleri veya bu istişareler devletler arası ilişkilere de ayrı bir dinamizm kazandırıyor. Ayrıca toplantılarımız ittifak politikalarının başarıya ulaştırılmasında önemli rol oynuyor. Kapsamlı güvenlik anlayışının öneminin arttığı günümüzde diyalog ve işbirliğini geliştirmeye her geçen gün daha çok ihtiyaç duyuyoruz. Bugün bu salonda sadece NATO üyesi 28 ülkenin değil, aynı zamanda Balkanlardan, Kafkasya'dan, Orta Doğu'dan, Uzak Doğu'dan ortak ve gözlemci ülkelerin temsilcileri de bulunuyor. Bu geniş katılım, ortak çıkar alanlarına ilişkin müşterek bakışımızın ve farklılıklardan yeni ortaklıklar üretme irademizin en açık ifadesidir. Aynı zamanda bu manzara, NATO'nun soğuk savaş sonrası dönemde geçirdiği dönüşümü de yansıtıyor. Daha da önemlisi, şahit olduğumuz bu fotoğrafı birlik ve beraberlik içinde hareket edebilme kabiliyetimizin bir provası olarak görüyorum. NATO üyesi ve gözlemci ülkeler olarak şayet içinde bulunduğumuz bu zor süreci hakkı, hukuku, adaleti, temel insani değerleri güçlendirerek geride bırakabilirsek kendimize ve tüm dünyaya katkıda bulunmuş oluruz. Aksi bir durumda ortaya çıkacak dengesizliğin hepimiz ve tüm dünya için felaketin habercisi olacağı da açıktır. Bunun için NATO'yu küresel görevlerinin gerektirdiği doğru bakış açıları ve buna uygun güçle donatmak için her zamankinden daha çok çalışmalıyız. Değerli misafirler, NATO Parlamenter Asamblesi'nin 62. Genel Kurul toplantısının İstanbul'da yapılmış olması başlı başına bir mesajdır. Tüm dünyanın dikkatinin Suriye'den Irak'a, Ukrayna'dan Libya'ya, Türkiye'nin çevresinde vuku bulan gelişmelere odaklandığı şu dönemde İstanbul'da toplanmış olmamız gerçekten çok önemlidir. Türkiye, NATO'nun gündeminde de üst sıralarda yer alan bu buhranlarla baş etmeyi günlük hayatının parçası haline getirmek zorunda kalan bir ülkedir. Bu toplantıyı dünyanın gündemini adeta bloke eden krizlere kayıtsız kalınmadığının bir işareti haline dönüştürmeliyiz. Temmuz ayında Varşova'da gerçekleştirilen NATO zirvesi sırasında ittifakın güvenliğini doğrudan ilgilendiren konularda kritik kararlar alındı. Tiran'da Mayıs ayında yapılan NATO Parlamenter Asamblesi oturumu Varşova zirvesi öncesinde delegelerimiz için önemli bir istişare ortamı sağladı. Varşova'da sağlanan ivmenin İstanbul'da yapılan görüşme ve çalışmalarla güçlendirildiğine inanıyorum. Unutulmamalıdır ki NATO hiçbir zaman sadece ortak tehditlere karşı kurulmuş bir savunma örgütü olmamıştır. NATO demokratik değerleri geliştirme idealine bağlı olan devletleri bir araya getirmiş bir güvenlik platformudur. Öyle olmak zorundadır. Bu toplantıyı önemli kılan bir başka husus da demokrasiye bağlılığını 15 Temmuz gecesinde canı pahasına dünyaya ispatlamış bir ülkede düzenleniyor olmasıdır. Kıymetli misafirler, 15 Temmuz gecesi Türkiye'de tarihte eşine ender rastlanacak bir demokrasi mücadelesi yaşanmış ve daha da önemlisi bu mücadele kazanılmıştır. O gece Türkiye ve bizimle birlikte tüm dünya terörün yeni bir yüzüne, terörle mücadelenin de farklı bir yöntemine şahit oldu. Türk milleti hangi kesimden, hangi siyasi görüşten olursa olsun 15 Temmuz gecesi istiklali ve istikbali için sokaklara dökülerek darbecilerin karşısına dikildi. Türkiye Büyük Millet Meclisi'ni bombalama hainliğini gösteren teröristlere en güçlü cevabı bizzat aziz milletimin seçilmiş temsilcileri verdi. Hangi siyasi partiye mensup olurlarsa olsunlar, tüm milletvekillerimiz tarihi bir dayanışma örneği sergileyerek üzerlerine bomba atıldığı anlarda dahi parlamentoyu terk etmediler. Medyamız çok zor şartlarda sürdürdüğü yayınını kesmeyerek birlik ve beraberlik çağrımızın halkımıza ulaştırılmasını sağladı. Türk demokrasisi rüştünü 15 Temmuz gecesinde tüm dünyaya bir kez daha ispatladı. Bugün şayet şahsım, bakan ve milletvekili arkadaşlarım burada sizlerle birlikteysek, milletimizin o gece gösterdiği destansı mücadele sayesindedir. Devletin ve toplumun FETÖ terör örgütünden arındırılması, o gece demokrasinin yanında duran ve bu uğurda 248 evladını kaybeden aziz milletimize karşı en büyük vazifemizdir. Bu nedenle 15 Temmuz'dan bu yana eli kanlı FETÖ terör örgütüyle kararlı bir şekilde mücadele ediyoruz. Türkiye Cumhuriyeti Anayasası'na uygun olarak 21 Temmuz günü ilan ettiğimiz olağanüstü hal çerçevesinde darbe girişiminin izlerini silmek, terör örgütlerini etkisiz hale getirmek için gereken her önlemi alıyoruz. Demokrasinin ve hukukun üstünlüğünün korunması için başlatılan bu süreç, anayasal sınırlar içerisinde temel hak ve özgürlükler gözetilerek sürdürülüyor. Bu vesileyle 15 Temmuz darbe girişiminin ardından ülkemizden desteğini esirgemeyen, dayanışma mesajlarını ileten dostlarımıza bir kez daha huzurlarınızda teşekkür ediyorum. Terör örgütlerinden kaynaklanan tehdit hepimize yöneliktir. Dolayısıyla mücadelenin de ortak verilmesi gerekiyor. Türkiye'ye sağlayacağınız destek, ortak güvenliğimize kasteden terör örgütüyle mücadelemize güç katacaktır. FETÖ ile iltisaklı yapılanmalara karşı mücadelemizde sizlerin desteğinize güveniyoruz. Aynı şekilde DAEŞ ve PKK başta olmak üzere insanlığın müşterek değerlerine düşmanlık konusunda birlikte hareket eden tüm terör örgütlerine karşı verdiğimiz mücadeleye desteğinizi bekliyoruz. Terör örgütleri mensuplarının ülkelerinizde rahatça hareket etmelerine, propaganda yapmalarına, militan devşirmelerine, tehditle haraç toplamalarına engel olmanızı istiyoruz. Özellikle Avrupa Birliği'nin terör örgütü olarak ilan ettiği PKK'nın Avrupa Birliği üyesi ülkelerde çok rahat dolaşmasını ve buralarda terörist başının posterleriyle aynı şekilde parlamento binasının koridorlarında afişleriyle cirit atmalarını terör mağduru bir ülke olarak biz hazmedemiyoruz. Dolayısıyla bu konuyla ilgili olarak tüm dostlarımızın gerekli tedbiri alması gerekir. Eğer gerekli tedbir alınmazsa bir gün bumerang gibi bu dönüp dolaşıp onları da vuracaktır. Bunun da haberini vereyim. Fransa'da olan olayları biliyorsunuz. Belçika'da olan olayları biliyorsunuz. Bütün bunların hepsi belli yerdeki duyarsızlığın işte aynı şekilde bir geri dönüşümüdür. NATO Genel Sekreteri Sayın Stoltenberg Eylül ayında ülkemizi ziyaret ederek NATO'nun ülkemizde olan dayanışmasını bir kez daha gösterdi. Yine Eylül ayında Sayın Meclis Başkanımızın girişimiyle düzenlenen demokrasi ve dayanışma zirvesine 8 uluslararası parlamenter asamblesinin katılım sağlamış olması da bizim için oldukça anlamlıdır. Ancak Türkiye olarak terörizme karşı yürüttüğümüz mücadelede daha güçlü bir desteğe ihtiyacımız olduğunu burada bizzat sizlere ifade etmek mecburiyetindeyim. Terör örgütleri karşısında ikircikli tutum içinde olan ülkelerin tamamı da bu tavırlarının bedelini eninde sonunda kendi toprakları içinde ödeyeceklerdir. Tarihin her döneminde farklı mahiyette terör örgütleriyle mücadele etmek zorunda kalan Türkiye'nin ikazlarına kulak verilmesini özellikle tavsiye ediyorum. Biz bu tecrübeyi on binlerce güvenlik görevlimizin ve vatandaşımızın canı pahasına elde ettik. Bilhassa dönemsel çıkarlar uğruna terör örgütlerine kol kanat geren ülkeleri Türkiye'nin bu samimi çağrısına kulak vermeye davet ediyorum. Şunu burada bir kez daha açık ve net ifade etmek isterim. Bizim kimsenin toprağında gözümüz yok. Kimsenin egemenlik haklarıyla bir sorunumuz da yok. Biz sadece tecrübelerimiz ışığında terör örgütlerini bizzat kaynağında imha etmeye çalışıyoruz. Türkiye terör örgütleriyle Avrupa başta olmak üzere dünyanın geri kalan bölümü arasında adeta bir set gibidir. Eğer biz bu mücadelede başarısız olursak, yani bu set yıkılırsa, teröristler tıpkı bir sel gibi tüm dünyayı ateşe ve kana bulayacaktır. Biz diyoruz ki, gelin bu seti zayıflatmak yerine güçlendirin. Terörizmle mücadelede Türkiye'ye verilen her destek, o ülkenin kendi geleceğini güvence altına almasına katkı sağlayacaktır. Tüm müttefiklerimizi meseleye bu şekilde bakmaya davet ediyoruz. Değerli dostlar, 1952'den bu yana üyesi olduğumuz NATO, 21. yüzyılın sınamalarıyla etkin biçimde mücadele edebilme iradesine sahip olduğunu ispatlamak zorundadır. Soğuk Savaş'ın sona erdiği dönemde bazı çevreler NATO'nun varlık nedeninin ortadan kalktığını hatırlayın, ileri sürdüler. Buna karşılık NATO, Soğuk Savaş'ın sona ermesinin ardından sergilediği adaptasyon yeteneği ve başlattığı kapsamlı dönüşüm süreciyle yeni bir döneme girdi. Bugün Balkanlardan Afganistan'a, Kuzey Afrika'dan Baltıklara uzanan geniş bir coğrafyada faaliyet gösteren NATO, uluslararası güvenlik ve istikrara önemli katkılarda bulunuyor. NATO bünyesinde, burasını özellikle ifade etmek istiyorum, İkinci büyük orduya sahip olan Türkiye, Soğuk Savaş boyunca Avrupa-Atlantik güvenliğinin vazgeçilmez bir parçasını oluşturmuştu. Türkiye yeni dönemde de uluslararası barışın korunmasına yönelik faaliyetlere güçlü bir şekilde askeri ve siyasi destek vermeyi sürdürüyor. Dünyayı ve NATO'yu ilgilendiren güvenlik krizlerinin önemli bir bölümü ülkemizin yakın çevresinde yaşanıyor. Türkiye bu krizler karşısında verdiği mücadelede hem kurumsal olarak NATO'yu hem de tek tek NATO üyesi ve gözlemcisi ülkeleri haklı olarak yanında görmek istiyor. Bilindiği gibi Suriye'deki krizin başından bu yana siyasi çözüm arayışlarında ön saflarda yer aldık. Aynı şekilde Suriye'de her geçen gün ağırlaşan insani sorunların çözümü konusunda hiçbir fedakarlıktan kaçınmadık. Ülkelerindeki çatışmalardan kaçan 3 milyona yakın Suriyeliye ve Iraklıya kapımızı açtık, onlara biz sahip çıktık. Şu ana kadar yapmış olduğumuz harcamalarda bizlere verilmesi gerekli olan, söz verilen destekler de ne yazık ki sadece cüzi bir miktarda kaldı. Ve bunlar yerine gelmedi. Ayrıca sınır hattımızın öteki tarafındaki yüz binlerce Suriyeliyi de açlığa ve ölüme terk etmedik. Bu inşalara acil, bu insanlara acil insani yardımda bulunduk. Türkiye'nin bu yükü omuzlayacak kudrette bir ülke olması esasen mevcut uluslararası kurumları da korudu. İşte Avrupa'ya bir mülteci akını söz konusu olduğu zaman Avrupa hemen panikledi. Birisi çıktı, ben 100 kişi alabilirim dedi. Öbürü çıktı, ben 200 kişi. Öbürü 500 kişi. Kimse rahat rahat Türkiye gibi kapısını açarak ne kadar gelirse gelsin ben alırım diyemedi. Biz şu anda bile hala onu söylüyoruz. Bombalardan kaçan herkese biz kapımızı açık tutmak zorundayız. Neden? Çünkü onlar insan. Biz o insanları bombaların altında bırakamayız. Sadece bir aylan bebeği dalgaların karaya attığı zaman, dünya dergilerinde kapak yaptıkları zaman feryat edenler, ama burada timsahın gözyaşlarını oynuyorlardı. Ümran bebekle ilgili o gözü kumlarla, topraklarla dolu olarak kan revan içinde dergilere kapak olduğu zaman timsah gözyaşlarını dökenler sadece ikircikli davranıyorlardı. Ama biz sadece bu olayı bu şekilde değerlendirmek değil, biz tavır koyarak yaşıyor, onların yanında yer aldığımızı ifade ediyorduk. İnsani krizlerin yükünün paylaşılması konusunda yalnız bırakılmış olmamız gerçekten çok acı bir durumdur ve gelecek için kötü bir örnektir. Şimdi burada ben bir gerçeği açıklamak zorundayım. İlgili ülkeler gücenmesin. Dost acı söyler ama gerçeği söyler. Bilir misiniz, Irak'ta ve Suriye'de bizim terör örgütü olarak ilan ettiğimiz örgütlerin elinde dostlarımızın ürettiği silahların çıktığını ve bu silahları seri numaralarına varıncaya kadar hepsi bizde mevcut. Bunları biliyoruz. Ama biz bunu kendilerine söylediğimiz zaman hiç ilgilenmiyorlar. Birileri kalkıyor diyor ki onlar eski dönemde verilmiş silahlardı. Öbürleri diyor ki biz PYD'yi, YPG'yi terör örgütü olarak kabul etmiyoruz. Niye? Çünkü onlar DAEŞ'e karşı savaşıyorlar. O zaman Nusra'yı da kabul etme. En-Nusra, o da DAEŞ'e karşı savaşıyor. Bir terörist bir başka teröriste karşı savaşıyor diye buna iyi diyebilir misiniz? Biz şu anda Suriye'de ve Irak'ta bunu görüyoruz. Biz bu bölgenin nabzını en iyi tutan ülkeyiz. Bu bölgenin ne olduğunu, tarihini en iyi anlatacak olan bilen biziz. Çünkü onlarla bizim tarihi, kültürel, her türlü birlikteliğimiz var. Akrabalık bağlarımız var. Şu anda Halep ne halde görüyorsunuz? Halep'i vuranlar belli. Fakat Halep'te yaşayanların Gaziantep ve Kilis'te yaşayanlarla akrabalık bağları olduğunu acaba Batı biliyor mu? Bu kadar iç içeyiz. Bu kadar birlikteyiz. Bizim böyle bir durumumuz var. Onun için bizim canımız yanıyor. Ama canı yanmayanlar sadece televizyon ekranlarına bakıp herhalde ah vah ediyorlar, o kadar. Milletimiz bütün bu manzara karşısında haklı bir öfke ve tepki içindedir. Diğer taraftan tarihinin en büyük güvenlik krizlerinden birini yaşamakta olan Irak'ta DAEŞ'la mücadele sürecine askeri, siyasi, toplumsal ve insani alanlarda katkılarda bulunmaya çalışıyoruz. Suriye'deki ve Irak'taki siyasi boşluktan ve dar görüşlü yönetimlerin tetiklediği mezhepçi kutuplaşmalardan beslenen terörizm belasına kararlılıkla karşı koymayı sürdüreceğiz. DAEŞ'le mücadelede Türkiye kadar büyük bedel ödeyen ve somut neticeler alan bir başka ülke yoktur. Bizler sınırda ciddi tehditler aldık. DAEŞ'ten aldık, PYD'den aldık, YPG'den aldık. Eğer Türkiye Özgür Suriye ordusuyla birlikte Suriye'ye girdiyse bunun sebebi bu tehdidi ortadan kaldırmak içindir. Çünkü yıllarca dostlarımıza şunu söyledim. Dedim ki gelin burada terörden arındırılmış bir güvenli bölge ilan edelim. EİT donatı biz yapalım. Ve burada özellikle yerleşim bölgelerinin inşaatını biz üstlenebiliriz. Siz bize mali destek verin. Üç, uçuşa yasak bölge ilan edelim. Ne yazık ki bize gayet güzel dedikleri halde hala bu işi sürüncemede bıraktılar ve bugüne kadar geldi. Temenni ederim ki bundan sonraki süreçte başta Amerika olmak üzere bunu yeniden ele alıp olumlu adımları atmak suretiyle burada terörün belini kırar ve bir NATO ülkesi olan Türkiye bu bölgede terör tehdidinden arındırılmış olur. Aynı şey Irak için de geçerli. Yabancı terörist savaşçıların kriz bölgelerine gidişini engellemek için bizler etkili önlemler aldık. Hala almaya devam ediyoruz. Bir başka önemli kriz alanı olan Ukrayna'da yaşanan sorunun bu ülkenin toprak bütünlüğü çerçevesinde çözülmesini hep destekledik. Çok güçlü tarihi bağlarımızın bulunduğu Kırım'da yaşanan insan hakları ihlallerinin takipçisiyiz. Takipçisi olmaya da devam edeceğiz. Kırım'ı kendimizden ayrı düşünemeyiz. Rusya ile ilişkilerimizde 24 Kasım hadisesi sonrasında başlatılan normalleşme sürecinde önemli bir ivme yakaladık. Bu sürecin bölgesel meselelere çözüm arayışları ve terörizmle mücadele çabalarına da olumlu yansımaları olacaktır diye düşünüyorum. Afganistan'daki sıkıntıların çözümüne yönelik önemli bölgesel girişimlere öncülük ediyoruz. Bu ülkede güvenlik ve istikrarın sağlanmasını temin etmek için ISAF bünyesinde önemli roller üstlendik. Afganistan'a olan desteğimizi kararlı destek misyonuyla sürdürüyoruz. Aynı şekilde 2001 yılından bu yana gerçekleştirdiğimiz 1 milyar dolar değerindeki 800'ü aşkın projeyle Afganistan'ın kalkınması ve yeniden inşasına ciddi katkılarda bulunduk. Türkiye'nin bölgesel barış ve istikrara yönelik yapıcı katkılarını gösteren bu örnekleri artırmak mümkündür. Gerek yakın çevresinde izlemiş olduğu politikalar, gerek bölgesel işbirliğini artırmaya matuf girişmeleriyle Türkiye, bölgesel ve uluslararası güvenliğin sağlanması konusunda aktif politikalar izlemeye devam edecektir. Kıymetli misafirler, uluslararası barış ve güvenlikten bahsederken, uluslararası meşruiyetin temsilcisi konumundaki Birleşmiş Milletler'in yeniden yapılandırılması gerektiğini bir kez daha bu toplantıda vurgulamak isterim. Esasen Birleşmiş Milletler son yıllarda çok önemli bir takım çalışmalara öncülük ediyor. Örneğin 2030 sürdürülebilir kalkınma gündemi hayata geçirilmeye başlandı. İnsanlığın geleceğini tehdit eden iklim değişikliğiyle mücadelede önemli bir aşama teşkil eden Paris Anlaşması bu arada imzalandı. Tarihinde ilk defa düzenlenen ve İstanbul'da ev sahipliği yaptığımız Dünya İnsani Zirvesi'nde herkes için ortak bir gelecek inşa etme yolunda ortak sorumluluk üstlenme iradesi ortaya konuldu. G20 dönem başkanlığımızın ardından dünyanın ilk küresel insani zirvesine ev sahipliği yapmaktan onur duyduk. Ancak tüm bu olumlu gelişmeler Birleşmiş Milletler'in başta Suriye olmak üzere birçok krizde yeterince etkin davranamadığı gerçeğini ortadan kaldırmıyor. Birleşmiş Milletler'in içinde bulunduğumuz krizlerle daha etkili mücadele edilmesine imkan sağlayacak şekilde yeniden yapılandırılması kaçınılmaz bir zorunluluk haline aldı. Sayın Ban Ki-moon, görev süresi boyunca Birleşmiş Milletler reformu ve özellikle barışı koruma faaliyetlerinin daha etkin hale getirilmesi yönünde çeşitli adımlar attı. Biz de Sayın Genel Sekreter'le öncülük ettiğimiz birçok girişim vesilesiyle yakın işbirliği içinde olduk. Hatta ta Kofi Annan döneminde başlattığımız Medeniyetler İttifakı'nın Birleşmiş Milletler çatısı altında Ban Ki-moon'la orada kurumsallaşmasını çok önemsedik ve gerekli desteği verdik. Bunun dışında Finlandiya ile birlikte kurduğumuz arabuluculuk dostlar grubunu ve İspanya ile hayata geçirdiğimiz az önce söylediğim Medeniyetler İttifakı girişimimizi bir kenara koymak mümkün değil. Öte yandan şu gerçeğin de artık herkes tarafından kabul edilmesi gerekiyor. Uluslararası barış ve güvenliğin temininden sorumlu ana organ olan Birleşmiş Milletler Güvenlik Konseyi yeni bir yapıya kavuşturulmadıkça bu çabalar tam manasıyla amacına ulaşamayacaktır. Israrla tekrar ediyorum. Güvenlik Konseyi günümüzün gerçekleriyle bağdaşan bir temsil yapısına kavuşturulmalıdır. Her fırsatta dünya beşten büyüktür derken işte bu gerçeği anlatıyorum. Ve anlatmaya devam edeceğim. Çünkü İkinci Dünya Savaşı'nın şartları içerisinde atılmış olan bu adımla bugünü yönetmek mümkün değildir. Dünyayı biz bir ülkenin dudakları arasına terk edemeyiz. 196 ülkenin burada hakkı vardır. Ve bütün bu ülkelerin burada yetki sahibi olması gerekir. 5 tane daimi üye ve bu daimi üyelerden bir tanesinin vereceği karar bütün dünyayı bağlayamaz. Bu adaleti tesis edemez. Burası insan haklarını temsil edemez ve güvence altına da alamaz. Güvenlik Konseyi'nde yer alacak her ülkenin bu hakkın getirdiği hesap verebilirliğe uygun hareket etmesini sağlayacak dünyanın nüfus, coğrafi ve inanç dağılımını yansıtacak bir sistemi hayata geçirmeliyiz. Güvenlik Konseyi'ni daha demokratik, adil, şeffaf ve etkin kılacak kapsamlı bir reform üzerinde mümkün olan en geniş uzlaşmayı sağlama sorumluluğu hepimize düşüyor. Değerli dostlar, uluslararası toplum olarak zor bir dönemden geçtiğimiz bir gerçektir. Ancak bunların aşılamayacak sorunlar olmadığını düşünüyorum. Bizler ortak çıkarlarımız çerçevesinde işbirliği ve dayanışma içinde hareket ettiğimiz müddetçe ne kadar karmaşık olursa olsun önümüze çıkan sorunlar karşısında güçlü bir duruş sergileyebiliriz. Bunu başarmak temsil ettiğimiz ülkelerle birlikte milletlerimizin asli birer unsurunu oluşturduğu uluslararası topluma karşı da en büyük görevimizdir. Elbette asıl sorumluluğumuz çocuklarımızadır. Gelecek nesilleredir. Onların daha huzurlu bir dünyada yaşayabilmesi için tüm bu zorlukları ve sınamaları başarıyla aşmak zorundayız. Ülkemde düzenlediğiniz bu toplantının gerek ittifak, gerek ortak ve dost ülkeler, gerekse tüm insanlık için hayırlara vesile olmasını niyaz ediyor. Çalışmalarınızda başarılar dilerken yeni dönem başkanına da şimdiden başarılar diliyor. Sizleri bir kez daha sevgiyle, saygıyla selamlıyorum. Kalın sağlıcakla.
We will now suspend this sitting for a coffee break. We will resume in about 1.5 hour for the address by the NATO Secretary General. Could I please ask the delegates to remain seated until our honored guests have left the room? And looking at my watch, it would be that we would reconvene at 10:20. 10:20.
Say hey, hey ha. Say test, alo. Hey, hey. Say hey, hey ha.
Call the meeting back to order if everyone would take their seats. I'm very honored to welcome the Secretary General Stoltenberg to our meeting at the NATO Parliamentary Assembly. As I know you are all aware, and the Secretary General is aware, we are very appreciative as the NATO Parliamentary Assembly of the attention that the Secretary General provides to the NATO Parliamentary Assembly. We are truly partners in the dialogue and in the assistance that we provide to the delegates and the parliamentarians. Secretary General, you've been very busy, and we look forward to your update today as a result of the Warsaw Summit in July, and you have the floor.
Mr. President, dear delegates, first of all, I would like to say that it's really an honor to be back here and to meet with you, this time in this beautiful city of Istanbul. Last time, I think we met in Norway, in Stavanger. And I will speak to you about the challenges and the tasks that NATO is facing and how NATO is responding. But before I do that, I would like to thank the Turkish Parliament for hosting us. And I would also like to thank the President, Mike Turner, for the excellent way he has chaired this assembly and the cooperation I have had with him. And we have met many different times in many different occasions, but I remember very well when Mike attended the NATO summit in Warsaw. He spoke to the leaders, and when you did that, I actually thought about the importance of having you representing the parliaments around the table with the heads of state and government in Warsaw. And I look forward to work with the new president, and I promise that I will continue to be in close contact with the NATO Parliamentary Assembly for many reasons, but not least because this assembly is a very important political body, because the NATO Parliamentary Assembly is truly a transatlantic institution, binding NATO together across the Atlantic with representatives from the European NATO allies, from Canada and the United States, and partner nations. And the bonds, the partnership, the friendship you create in this assembly is important for the whole alliance because it strengthens the transatlantic bond. Second, this assembly is important because you are representing the national parliaments. And I believe I've said this before, but I will repeat it because it is so important. I have been a parliamentarian myself, and I know the importance of parliaments in decision-making in the different NATO-allied countries. Because parliaments decide on the guidelines, the framework for defense and security policies, no government can conduct in the long term a policy which is against the will of the parliaments. So therefore, what you decide, what you agree, is of great importance for what NATO can do and what NATO allies are able to agree on. You are key for key decisions for NATO, like, for instance, defense spending. And that has been my main focus since I became Secretary General in 2014, is how can we increase defense spending among those NATO allies which are spending less than 2%. And that is actually your main responsibility, is to decide budgets. And therefore, I know that to speak to you is of great importance for me, because you are the representatives representing those parliaments which are at the end deciding defense spending in the different NATO allied countries. You are also key for another reason, and that is because parliaments actually decide who is going to be member of NATO. And you know that we are now in the process of inviting the process of enlarging NATO with a new member, Montenegro. The accession treaty is signed. What remains to be done is the ratification. And many nations have already ratified the accession agreement for Montenegro. It has to be done in all 28 parliaments. So I urge those parliaments, I urge those countries that have
not yet signed, no, sorry, ratified the accession agreement for Montenegro to do so. This is a responsibility for you, for the parliaments, and I speak directly to you. Go back to your parliaments, make sure that you ratify that accession agreement as soon as possible. We will have a summit in NATO next year, and it is really something I think we should be able to deliver by the summit next year, that we have the accession agreement ratified by all parliaments, so we can welcome Montenegro as a full member by the summit in 2017, and that may happen early 17, so you have to hurry up and to ratify the accession agreement. So as you understand, I attach great importance to the NATO Parliamentary Assembly because you represent parliaments which are so important for our alliance. There is yet another reason why I believe that this assembly is of great importance, and that is just the plain fact that you represent different parties, different nations, different political opinions. So the NATO Parliamentary Assembly is a platform for political discussion, for political exchange between different people, different opinions. And I think this magnitude, this variety of opinions are of great importance in itself, because it reflects that NATO is an alliance of 28 democracies. There are disagreements, there are different views, there are different positions on many issues, but the strength of NATO is that we have always been able to agree on the core task, on our core responsibility, and to stand together on the message that we are here to protect each other, to defend each other, and to stand together in the strongest alliance of the world. And that was actually also what we managed to do at Warsaw. At the summit, we made important decisions on collective defense, on projecting stability, and on working together with the European Union to strengthen our cooperation with the European Union. And I will address briefly these issues, and then I'm more than happy to answer questions on all the other issues, and also elaborate a bit more on collective defense, projected stability, later on during the Q&A session. But before I do that, I would just also remind us all of the fact that we are meeting here in Turkey 4 short months after the failed coup attempt. This should be a sober reminder to us all, a reminder that democracy and freedom cannot be taken for granted. They must be vigorously defended. In September, I visited the Grand National Assembly in Ankara, which had been shelled by tanks and F-16s, bombed by F-16s. I saw the damage that was done, and I met members of the parliament from all major political parties. They rushed to the parliament on the night of the coup attempt and stood together in defense of their democratic institutions. It made a lasting impression on me, and I want to salute them today for their courage and dedication to democracy. Democracy, individual liberty, and the rule of law are NATO's core values, and I personally attach great importance to them, as you do, members of the NATO Parliamentary Assembly. And the NATO Parliamentary Assembly is a platform for democratic debate and open exchange of different views among parliamentarians from all our member states and partner countries. And the important thing is that, given that we all represent different nations and we represent different political parties, we again and again have proven that we are able to stand together in the alliance on the main message of collective defense and the will to defend each other. And that was exactly what we did in Warsaw. And we decided to strengthen our collective defense in response to Russia's aggressive actions in Ukraine and ongoing military buildup of Russia. NATO has taken prudent and necessary steps. We are increasing our defensive presence in the eastern part of the alliance, including the deployment of 4 multinational battalions to the Baltic states and Poland. Earlier this year, Canada, Germany, the United Kingdom, and the United States each committed to lead 1 of those battalions. And I want to thank those nations for their leadership. I also want to express my appreciation to the 13 other allies that have pledged to join these forces. Our preparations for the 4 battalions are on track. We expect to deploy all 4 battalions in early 2017. This sends a clear message. NATO is united. We stand together as one. And an attack on one ally will be considered an attack against us all. NATO is also taking steps to strengthen our presence in the Black Sea region. There will be a Romanian-led multinational brigade, and we are working on additional defensive measures in the air and at sea as well. Everything NATO does is defensive, proportionate, and fully in line with our international commitments. Before Russia's aggressive actions in Ukraine, NATO had no plans to send troops to the eastern part of our alliance. NATO's aim is to prevent a conflict, not to provoke a conflict. Moreover, we firmly believe and we are firmly committed to a two-track approach to Russia. Strong defense coupled with meaningful dialogue. When tensions run high, it is even more important to keep channels of communication open. With increasing military activity close to our borders, we must do everything we can to prevent military incidents or accidents. And if they do occur, we must keep them from spiraling out of control. That is why we held 2 meetings of the NATO-Russia Council this year. The other major theme at the Warsaw Summit was projecting stability. We know that if our neighbors are stable, we are more secure. NATO helps to build stability in our neighborhood through capacity building, training, working with partners, and maritime security. NATO has been on the front line in the fight against terrorism for many years, including through our operation and military presence in Afghanistan, which was launched in the response of the 9/11 terrorist attacks against the United States. And as you know, this is the first and the only time NATO has invoked our collective defense clause, Article 5. Our experience in Afghanistan has shown that having strong, highly trained local forces is vital to a country's security and stability. Training local forces is one of our best weapons in the fight against terrorism. This year alone, we have trained hundreds of Iraqi officers in Jordan, and we recently decided to extend our training and capacity efforts, building efforts into Iraq. That work will begin early next year. This training is an important contribution to the fight against ISIL, as is our AWACS surveillance aircraft, now flying from Konya here in Turkey in support of the counter-ISIL coalition. The situation in the Mediterranean remains serious, In response, earlier this month, we launched NATO's new maritime security operation, Sea Guardian. This operation will help protect the safety and the security of one of the world's busiest bodies of water. NATO's ships, submarines, and maritime patrol aircraft will perform core activities like surveillance, counterterrorism, and capacity building of regional navies. And NATO is supporting EU's Operation Sophia with information sharing and logistical support. This cooperation with the European Union in the Mediterranean is just one example of the benefit of closer cooperation between NATO and the European Union. The two organizations have transformed Europe, building the foundation for peace, security, and prosperity. And I'm pleased to say that NATO-EU cooperation is now closer than it has ever been. And this was underscored by the joint declaration I signed with the two presidents, Tusk and Juncker, in Warsaw in July. And there is a momentum in the NATO-EU cooperation, and we must take this momentum, this opportunity to further strengthen and to do more in the field of NATO-EU cooperation. We are exploring ways to work together to counter hybrid threats, enhance cybersecurity, and coordinate exercises. As you all know, the European Union is considering options for strengthening European defense. And I welcome that initiative because it offers a way for European allies to deliver more capabilities and increased defense spending. Doing so will strengthen Europe, the EU, and NATO. It is important to make sure that those efforts are complementary, transparent, and mutually supportive, and that non-EU allies are closely involved because they make essential contributions to European security. A stronger Europe will mean a stronger NATO, and it will reinforce the transatlantic bond, a bond that has served the vital security interests of NATO members on both sides of the Atlantic. With that in mind, I am welcoming the incoming administration in Washington. And I look forward to working with President-elect Donald Trump. The partnership between Europe and the United States has been rock solid for almost 70 years. A partnership that has always received bipartisan support in the United States. And better burden sharing will make the transatlantic bond even stronger. After years of sliding defense spending, we have seen a shift. At our Wales summit in 2014, allies committed to spend 2% of GDP on defense within a decade. That commitment is already bearing fruit. In 2015, we stopped the defense cuts and we saw a spending increase across Europe and Canada. I expect further increase of 3% for European allies and Canada this year. So we are moving in the right direction, but we have a long way to go. And defense spending to reach the 2% target really matters. And let me illustrate by the following example. If all European allies and Canada were to meet the 2% spending target, that would mean an extra $100 billion worth of improvements to our capabilities. That is roughly the equivalent to the combined defense budgets of the two largest defense spenders in Europe, the United Kingdom and France, every year. This is where all of you come in. I'm confident that NATO can count on your continued support, just as we have relied on the support of the NATO Parliamentary Assembly over the past 6 decades. Since the founding of NATO in 1949, we have helped to secure the peace and provide the foundation for freedom and prosperity, supported by our citizens and their elected representatives, and dedicated to continued peace and security for our people and for future generations. So thank you for your support, thank you for your attention, and I'm looking forward to continue to work with all of you to strengthen the transatlantic bond and to strengthen NATO. Thank you.
Secretary General, thank you for your very thoughtful comments. They mirror the discussions that we've been having for the past 2 days here in our annual session. You've kindly agreed to take questions, and this is our opportunity to get information directly from you that we take directly back to our parliaments. To remind everyone of the procedure, I will announce those who've been called on to ask questions in groups of three so that you will be prepared. Anyone who would like to ask the Secretary General a question, please let the gentleman know to my left. They'll be keeping track. And please raise your hand so that the staff and the Secretariat can identify you and pass your names on. There will be a two-minute limit for all questions. And, of course, we cannot guarantee that everyone will be able to ask their questions. We have just slightly over an hour of where the Secretary General has agreed to take questions. Our first group of three will be Ants of Estonia, Ricardo of Spain, and Gilbert from France. Ants, you can begin with your question.
Thank you, Mr. President. It's well known that Russia is increasing and quickly increasing its military power in the western part of the country. NATO response to the Russian war preparations have been approved during the Warsaw Summit last July. For the eastern members of the alliance, I mean Baltic states and Poland, it will be realized by sending 4 NATO battalion task forces into our countries, I mean one into each one. United States has promised to send additionally 1 armored brigade into Poland. But if we compare the balance of power between Russia and Baltic states, it's evident that 3 Baltic states, even with NATO battalions, are not able to create some deterrence and protect themselves appropriate way in case of aggression. The next year budget in Estonia has passed 2 readings in our parliament. 3rd and last one will be this week. We are going to spend 2.18% from our GDP for increasing our self-defense capability. I know our neighbors are doing the same, but as a small countries, we are not able to create significant military power, especially medium and long range air defense, effective coast defense, navy, to keep open and protected maritime and air communication lines across the Baltic Sea in case of crisis. We need more NATO forces on the ground and in the Baltic Sea. Mr. Secretary General, you are a leader of NATO. What is your opinion and approach? How it will be better to solve security problems in the Baltic area in framework of deterrence? Thank you.
This is a very large room and the acoustics are somewhat difficult. I would like to ask everyone when they do ask their questions to try to be as close to the microphone as possible. We'll turn to Ricardo from Spain.
Thank you, Mr. President. I shall speak in Spanish. Señor Secretario General, usted ha dicho que la relación Unión Europea-OTAN es hoy más fuerte que nunca, más amigable. Hoy, 4 países miembros de la Unión Europea y a la vez miembros de la OTAN están impulsando un paquete de medidas para revitalizar la defensa europea y hacerla más fuerte, más realista y más creíble, dotando de autonomía estratégica a la Unión Europea en el terreno operacional e industrial. Estos cuatro países consideran necesario contar con una capacidad eficiente para planear y conducir misiones y operaciones de política común de seguridad y defensa. Algunos países ven esto como un peligro, como una ruptura con la OTAN. Yo considero que, como usted, que es una oportunidad. ¿Cómo podemos superar esos recelos? Gracias.
Gilbert, France.
Monsieur le secrétaire général, je souhaiterais évoquer une question de défense collective de l'Europe. Comme vous le savez, les ministres allemands et français de la défense, Madame von der Leyen et Monsieur Le Drian, ont pris en septembre dernier une initiative à laquelle se sont ensuite fort heureusement associés les ministres espagnols et italiens de la défense pour une défense européenne robuste. Ce n'est pas pour créer une armée européenne au sein de l'Union, ni pour dupliquer l'OTAN, mais l'objectif est au contraire de renforcer les capacités de défense collective et de projection de stabilité en Europe. Monsieur le secrétaire général, nous sommes donc devant une équation qui fait que la défense, plus de défense de l'Europe par les Européens ne signifie pas moins d'OTAN, mais au contraire, une défense collective plus efficace. C'est d'ailleurs ce que vous avez dit dans vos propos. Vous connaissez ce projet et ses objectifs. Il est tout à fait dans la ligne des conclusions du sommet de Varsovie. Est-ce que vous pouvez nous indiquer quels sont, de votre point de vue, les résultats que devrait atteindre cette initiative?
Monsieur le Secrétaire général.
Thank you so much. Actually, I will start with the two last questions because they are very much interlinked, because they both address the issue of stronger European defense and the debate and discussions and the process inside the European Union now addressing how to strengthen European defense. And I welcome that initiative, I welcome that debate, and I strongly believe that a stronger Europe can contribute to a stronger NATO. And that is also the clear message from the European leaders I have met. The discussion is still going on, but the message is that this is not about creating an alternative to NATO, but this is about strengthening the European pillar inside NATO. That was exactly what, for instance, the German Defense Minister Ursula von der Leyen recently stated, that this is about creating a stronger European pillar inside NATO. And that is, of course, something I welcome, because NATO, have called for a strong European defense for decades, and that has also been the message from the United States and many other non-EU allies, that Europe has to invest more in defense and strengthen its defenses. The only thing we have to avoid is that when Europe starts to strengthen its defenses, it is done in a way which is complementary to NATO, not competing with NATO. And that has been clearly stated, that that is the aim, to not compete, but to complement. And therefore, I welcome that many European leaders have so clearly stated that this is, as you also said, Gilbert from France, that this is not about the European army. This is not about establishing shape-like command structures or about the European Union starting to do collective defense. But it is about strengthening Europe's ability to provide defense as a part of NATO for those 22 allies that are both NATO allies and European Union members at the same time. Let me also add that this is in one way obvious, because we have to remember that especially after Brexit, EU is important, but compared to the rest of NATO, especially when you take into account the United States, of course NATO has capabilities and strength which is not covered by the European Union. 80% of NATO's defense spending will come from non-EU allies after Brexit, 80%. And 3 out of 4 battalions, which we are going to deploy to the eastern part of the alliance, so to the Baltic countries and Poland, will be led by non-EU allies. So it goes, in a way, the United Kingdom, also after Brexit, Canada and the United States. So I think it's obvious that we cannot decouple European security from North America, and we cannot decouple the security of the European Union members from the rest of Europe, because there are some European nations which are not member of the European Union, and I regret at least for one of them not being there. And they also contribute to the security of Europe. So that was a long answer to two questions. Estonia answers. I think we have to understand the following, that the four battalions, they are important because they are multinational. They are led by Canada, UK, United States, and Germany, but they are also then there will be support and other nations contributing, so they will be truly multinational battalions in the three Baltic countries and Poland. And by being multinational battalions, they are sending a very clear signal that an attack on one ally will trigger the response from the whole alliance. But we don't believe that the battalions is the only element in creating the necessary deterrence and defense for the Baltic countries and Poland and for the rest of the alliance as well. Because there are only one building block in a comprehensive response. We have the four battalions, but then we have and then of course we have national defense forces, like for instance in Estonia, and I welcome that Estonia is one of the countries which are spending already more than 2% of defense. And I know that Poland is also doing that already, and then the two other Baltic countries, Lithuania and Latvia, are very close to meet the 2% target. They will meet it in 2017 or 2018. So the battalions are important, but of course also the home defense forces are important, and they are becoming stronger and stronger in these three Baltic countries and in Poland. But then we also have the new small headquarters, the NFIUs, which are not so big, but they are critical for coupling the national home defense forces with the NATO forces, and to plan, exercise, and facilitate reinforcements if needed. And then we are strengthening our ability to reinforce. We have tripled, as President Mike Turner said in his speech, we have tripled the size of the NATO response force to 40,000. And at its core, we have the VJTF, the Spearhead Force, ready to move within days. So if needed, we can reinforce quickly to strengthen our deterrence in the Baltic region. So we have to understand all of this together, and NATO is able and will continue to be able to provide credible deterrence. And as you know, the reason to have a strong defense and the reason to have a credible deterrence is not because we want to fight a war, but it's because we know that credible deterrence is the best way to prevent a war. We don't want to provoke a war, but we know that a firm, credible deterrence is the best way to prevent a war.
Thank you. Our next group of three will begin with Julio from Portugal, Ojars from Latvia, and then Corian of Armenia. Julio, you have the floor.
Well, thank you, President. First of all, I would like to compliment the speech of the Secretary General. And we believe in a strong security efforts linked to a strong transatlantic relation. And I could congratulate the Secretary General for his talks with the new administration of the United States in order to went on and deepen this relation in order to prevent our security. I have only two questions related, first of all, about the Middle East, and it is always NATO capacity building efforts in Iraq as part of supporter measure for anti-Daesh campaign, and this is related also to announced Russian permanent presence in Syria. Is this mean something to the movements of NATO? And last but not least, how NATO responded to the increasing militarization of the Arctic. At least there is a kind of a militarization made by Russia. So what is the response and what is the strategy of NATO about this? Thank you very much.
Ojars.
Thank you, Mr. President. Secretary General, as you made in your remarks, clearly Europe has to do more to strengthen its contribution to defense and to NATO. But it seems that heretofore, European contributions to NATO, and especially the European response to Article 5 after 9/11, has not been sufficiently recognized in the United States. This was particularly noticeable during the presidential election. Can NATO's public diplomacy do more to convince our American friends of Europe's ongoing commitment to NATO, NATO's collective defense? Our strategic communication program is focused on deliberate disinformation on Russia's borderlands, but would you agree that we must also combat inadvertent misinformation about what's happening within NATO in our own countries? Thank you.
Korean, Armenia.
Secretary General, firstly, on November 18th, at German Marshall Fund, you stated the strategic geographical location of Turkey, bordering Russia in the north and the Black Sea, Georgia, and then bordering Iraq and Syria to the south. Perhaps you missed to mention Armenia as a bordering country. As you know, the border with Armenia has been closed by Turkish government since 1994. This is one of the security challenges in our region. Do you have any plans to raise this issue with Ankara so that to help open the last closed border in free Europe? Secondly, in the light of the political military developments and crisis situation in the Middle East, what is the vision of NATO on stopping the movement of foreign fighters to the Middle East? Free movement of mercenaries from the region forms a potential possibility of emergence of network of foreign fighters that would be difficult to detect and defeat. What's your view on the possible mechanism to stop the flow of foreign fighters and increasing security guarantees for refugees in the Middle East and migrants hosted temporarily in some of frontline states in the region? Thank you.
Mr. Secretary General.
First, on Russia in Syria and Russia in the Arctic, that was two of the questions from Julio. We have seen a significant build-up of Russia in Syria, and we have seen it on land with especially air forces, but also with ground troops, and we have seen it in the territorial waters outside Syria and in the eastern Mediterranean. And we have seen that they have conducted airstrikes again and again against many different targets in Syria, and we have seen that they have used both planes based in Syria, but also missiles from the Caspian Sea, but now also planes from the aircraft carrier group Kuznetsov. So they are using many different capabilities in and around Syria to attack targets in Syria. And they do this together with the Syrian regime. And Syria and the Assad regime, they are responsible for indiscriminate bombing of Aleppo, of other cities in Syria. And we have seen the consequences. Civilians are killed. Innocent people are killed. And critical infrastructure, such as hospitals, are attacked. And the humanitarian tragedy in Syria becomes even worse because we have seen a surge in the air attacks against Aleppo and other cities in Syria. This is something that has to stop because this is only adding to the human suffering in Syria. We all know that it's not easy, but it is the only possible solution to the conflict in Syria is to continue to strive for a political solution, for a negotiated solution. And the first step is a ceasefire, cessation of the hostilities, and the free access and safe access of humanitarian aid to those most affected in Aleppo and in other cities. And then based on that, we need a negotiated, lasting political solution. Because the bombing, which is conducted by the Syrian and the Russian air forces, is just adding to the human suffering in Syria. Then on the Arctic, we have seen some more Russian presence in the Arctic. At the same time, I think it is important to underline that the Arctic is still an area where we have low tensions and where we have a high degree of cooperation between NATO allies like Norway and Denmark and also the United States and Canada with Russia under the umbrella of the Arctic Council, but also bilaterally. There is a lot of cooperation. I know between, for instance, the Norwegian fleet and also the Norwegian armed forces, there is cooperation with the Russian North fleet and with the Russian military authorities at the Kola Peninsula related to, for instance, search and rescue. And I will very much urge all the NATO allies in the Arctic region to continue to, of course, maintain military presence in the Arctic, but at the same time continue to strive for low tensions and a high degree of cooperation. That is important for all of us, and I think it also illustrates that even in times with high tensions, where tensions are running high as now, we are able to also in some areas have a pragmatic a working relationship with Russia, as many NATO allies have with Russia in the high north. Then, Ojas from Latvia. I had the pleasure of speaking to President-elect Donald Trump on Friday, and he expressed very strong support for the NATO alliance. And he expressed a strong commitment on continued strong NATO or U.S. support for the NATO alliance and U.S. support for the security of Europe and collective defense. So I look forward to work with him, and I'm absolutely certain that also with the new administration we will have an administration in the United States which is absolutely committed to the NATO alliance. And he also stated, as he has stated in the election campaign, that he will strengthen further U.S. defense capabilities and increase defense spending. But of course, he also pointed that during the election campaign and in the phone call he and I had on Friday, the importance of increased defense spending among European allies. And that's something I absolutely, what should I say, understand. Because actually all European allies and Canada, we have decided, we have pledged that we will stop the cuts and increase and aim at 2% within a decade. And we were together around the table in Wales in 2014, and we promised the Americans and the others who are not already spending 2% that the others will also reach 2%. And we reiterated that pledge in Warsaw in July. So, we have to deliver. It's very hard to tell the Americans, but also, for instance, in London and other countries which are spending 2%, that some allies are not going to meet the pledge, not going to make good on the promises we all made together. So, we have to deliver. We have made the pledge. And we are a collective alliance, collective defense. And if we expect the Americans to make good on their promise to defend us, the Europeans, then of course we Europeans have to make good on our pledge to them to have a fairer burden sharing. So that's something we have to work on, all of us. And that's actually a responsibility for you and me to make sure that happens. Thank you.
Our next group of three begins with Zan of Slovenia, Irina of Ukraine, and then Raza of Lithuania. We'll begin with Zan of Slovenia.
Thank you, President. I wanted to raise a question about the necessity of a European army, but since my colleagues from France and Spain already asked that and you highlighted some points in your speech, I withdraw the question. Thank you.
Arina of Ukraine.
Thank you. Good day, esteemed colleagues. Thank you, Secretary General, for your comprehensive description of NATO's present and future policy. Today in Ukraine, in the third anniversary of the Revolution of Dignity, Ukrainians defended their independent European future. And immediately after that, Russia started its aggression, occupied Crimea, undermined stability of the eastern territories of Ukraine. Now Ukraine allocates 5% of its GDP for defense. We Ukrainians highly appreciate that from the very beginning NATO and NATO Parliamentary Assembly supported Ukraine and continue to do so. It's very important for us. During the last 2 days, we have extensively discussed defense and deterrence in NATO's eastern and southeastern flanks in response to Russian aggression. In this context, I would like to underline again that aggressive Russia is our common security challenge. The better surpassed Ukraine and NATO should unify efforts. Thus, I would like to ask, Ukraine is interested in maximum active partners' role in NATO's future defense on the eastern and southeastern flank, including in the Black Sea, as non-member state. Do you see such role for Ukraine?
For our speakers, please remember the acoustics in the room, and please get very close to the microphone. We're going to turn to Raza of Lithuania.
Thank you, Mr. President. Mr. Secretary General, my question will be on NATO decision-making process in crisis. When we rely on rapid reaction as deterrence, reacting fast in an early phase of crisis is crucial, as it is much more difficult to regain lost territory than not to allow to occupy it. So my question is whether the steps NATO has taken so far to streamline NATO decision-making and to delegate some decisions to NATO military authorities are sufficient in the face of a crisis, or whether we still have some issues that we need to streamline. And another critical aspect, of course, is the speed of the decision-making process in our capitals. Can we be certain that if a crisis arises, there will be no delays caused by national decision-making procedures? Should certain allies take steps to review these proceedings on the national level? Thank you.
Mr. Secretary General.
Thank you. First, I forgot to answer the question from Romania and
Armenia.
Yes, and then because the first question was about borders and border issues between Turkey and Armenia, and that's a bilateral issue. So I think it's an issue and something that has been that has to be raised on the bilateral level between Armenia and Turkey. The other question was related to foreign fighters, and NATO is of course very concerned and very focused on the challenges and the threats related to homecoming or returning foreign fighters, and that's one of the reasons why we have agreed and decided to do more when it comes to intelligence. Improve the way we share and work on intelligence, but also to improve the mechanisms we have when it comes to sharing intelligence, especially related to foreign fighters, because that is a challenge for many NATO allies. And as you know, we have decided to establish a new division inside the NATO headquarters, which is dedicated to intelligence. And there will be a new assistant secretary general, which main responsibility will be intelligence, reflecting the increased focus we are now attaching to intelligence, especially related to countering terrorism, and foreign fighters is a part of that. Then Ukraine, Irina on Ukraine. NATO provides strong political and strong practical support for Ukraine. We provide strong political support, stating again and again that we will never accept the illegal annexation of Crimea, and we continue to support the territorial integrity and the sovereignty of Ukraine. We also provide political support for Ukraine when it comes to the Minsk process, and the only way to a peaceful, lasting solution is the full implementation of the Minsk agreements, ceasefire, withdrawal of heavy weapons, and safe and full access for the OSCE observers so they can monitor the implementation of the Minsk agreements. And Russia has to stop supporting the separatists in eastern Ukraine. We also provide practical support with our different trust funds, helping build the defense institutions, and many NATO allies also provide direct bilateral support, for instance, when it comes to training. And I visited Ukraine last year, where I attended a big exercise on civil disaster management, a NATO exercise that was hosted by Ukraine with NATO allies and partner countries. And of course, you asked whether we would do more. Yes, we are constantly looking into what more we can do with Ukraine to strengthen our partnership, to work more with Ukraine. And I met President Poroshenko recently in NATO headquarters, and we are working on the implementation of the substantial package to make sure that we, in many different fields, are stepping up our cooperation and our support for Ukraine. Then Rasa from Lithuania. As you said, we have streamlined our decision-making, and we are also developing the plans, the different kinds of contingency plans we have to make sure that we can make decisions and then rapidly implement plans. And this is, of course, also very closely connected to the increased readiness of NATO. Because, as I said, having tripled the size of the NATO response force and having established a NATO spearhead force, we are able also not only to make decisions and to have the plans, but we also have capabilities which can be used on very short notice. And we are also increasing our situational awareness. We will soon have new drones deployed in Sicily, Alliance ground surveillance drones, and around that the whole system of managing or processing the information that the drones will gather or collect. And all of this better early warning, better intelligence is also helping us to make the right decisions in time, because we are more prepared, we have more time for notice when we have better intelligence and better surveillance, and we are stepping up and delivering concrete results in these areas. Then we are also doing exercises, and that's also a way to improve our decision-making procedures and to challenge and to prepare us also for difficult decisions which have to be made quickly in times of crisis. I would also like to say that we have examples, for instance, related to the military operation in Libya, where NATO was able to make decisions very quickly to take the command and the control of the Libya operation back in 2011. We decided to invoke Article 5 just a few days after the attack on the United States in 2001. And the Aegean activity, which is not a combat operation, we were able to make the decision and to deploy ships in the Aegean. I think it was within 48 hours. So there are different examples on how NATO, in very different tasks and missions, can make quick decisions when needed. Decision-making is key to our deterrence and defense. Thank you.
Our next group of three will begin with Richard from the UK, Oyvind of Norway, and Irakli from Georgia. Richard, you have the floor.
Thank you, President. I'm only half joking when I suggest that the questions of these sessions could perhaps first be allocated to delegations from countries that are spending 2% on defense. Matter has been raised with us by commanders at NATO headquarters, that people of real caliber are allocated to them from alliance countries, but those commanders are not given the flexibility to use those people as they would wish for the tasks that they are given. Could I ask you to look at this to see whether greater flexibility could be given to commanders to be able to use staff officers sent and in how they're deployed? Thank you, Secretary General, for your plea for actions to meet the aspirations of the Wales summit for 2% to be spent. To make this easier, greater credibility could be given if the good work that you've done on transparency of NATO's funding and finances could be continued, and we'd like to hear an update from you on this. I know great progress has been made, but we continue to be concerned that greater transparency on the funding, on the finances of NATO continues. And finally, just to say to you that if European countries are looking for examples of how cooperation between European countries in defence matters works, could they look at the arrangement, the Lancaster House Agreement between France and the United Kingdom, which is now deep and resilient, and most importantly, increases the capacity of both countries to operate in the defence field, therefore making our joint investment in defence go further.
Oyvind in Norway.
Thank you, Mr. President. I'd like to thank the Secretary General for an excellent briefing, but I would like you to go a little deeper into the situation in the Eastern Mediterranean and the role of NATO. Russia continues to increase the military footprints in Syria. Civilians are suffering, and now we heard that the last operating hospital in Aleppo are attacked. The Russian military operation in support of the Syrian regime has at many occasions also challenged the Allied operations against ISIL. The buildup of Russia's forces in the area and its capacity for anti-access and area denial could pose a future challenge far into Allied territory. The question is, what measure should be undertaken by NATO in order to address this challenge in the Eastern Mediterranean and NATO's southern border? Thank you.
Irakli, Georgia.
Thank you, Mr. President. Mr. Secretary General, thank you for your insightful and comprehensive presentation. Dear colleagues, recent parliamentary elections in Georgia once again underlined the country's democratic maturity. And I am proud to state that the election process in Georgia by all international observation missions was assessed positively. We will remain committed to core values of democracy and continue to be a reliable aspirant country. We are confident that Georgia's integration into European and Euro-Atlantic institutions is on the right track, and we are determined to achieve this goal. Secretary General, as you are aware, Georgia is actively engaged in strategic discussions on the Black Sea security issues. And from your point of view, how this process can contribute to Georgia's resilience, defensibility, and security? And finally, I would like to know that next year, NATO PA spring session will take place in Georgia. And we would be honored to host all of you in Tbilisi and Mr. Secretary General, you personally. Thank you.
Mr. Secretary General.
Thank you so much. First, some responses to the questions from Richard from the United Kingdom. First, on flexibility for NATO commanders to be able to use the different staffs or officers which are assigned to them from different NATO allied countries. Well, you're pointing at an important thing or an important task or issue, and we have decided and we have just started to implement a functional assessment of the NATO command structure where we actually are looking into how is the NATO command structure functioning today, And is there any need for changes? That will be, in a way, the next step. And, of course, this may be one of the elements that can be addressed as part of the process we have just started to address the functional assessment of the NATO command structure. Let me then add on a more personal note that I think that we have to admit the following, that nations very much like to control what they are sending to NATO. And sometimes there is a conflict between efficient, what's I say, management of the resources and national control. Because if every nation wants maximum control on each officer and each person they are sending to NATO, of course it's not so easy to manage the command structures. So again, I think this is partly what I do, we do at the NATO headquarters, but I think it's also what you do in your different capitals, trying to convince the nations that more flexibility, which will then mean some reduced control from capitals, will actually in the long run benefit all of us. So I will look into the question of flexibility, but I also in this issue depend on your support addressing or raising this issue in the different capitals, because at the end it has to be capitals that allows us to have more flexibility at NATO headquarters. Then 2%, so UK is one of the countries that meet the guideline of 2%. That's of great importance because UK then is able to finance many important capabilities for NATO. But UK is also an example for all the other allies that it is possible to reach the 2% target. And 2% defense spending is an issue I have raised in all my meetings in capitals since I became Secretary General. I continue to do so. I'm encouraged by the fact that we have stopped the cuts, but we have a very, very long way to go, so there's no way we can relax. And I met with prime ministers, I met with defense ministers and foreign ministers, but in some capitals I also asked to meet the Minister of Finance, because the problem is never the Minister of Defense. He or she is always in favor of increased defense spending, and normally also foreign ministers are, and defense ministers, and so on. So I think it is important also to address those who are responsible for the budget, prime ministers and Minister of Finance. And I can tell you that when I was Minister of Finance in Norway back in the 1990s, I was actually responsible for cutting defense spending. And I was quite proud of that because I increased the budget surplus in Norway by cutting defense spending in Norway in the 1990s. But then when I was prime minister, I was actually responsible for starting to increase defense spending in Norway after the Russian attack on Georgia or aggression against Georgia in 2008. And the reason why I tell you this is that in one way it's completely understandable, and I understand because I was part of it myself, that when tensions went down after the Cold War, it was in a way natural that defense spending went down. But when tensions started to increase again, then we have to be able to increase defense spending. So if we cut defense spending when tensions are decreasing, we have to be able to increase defense spending when tensions are increasing. So, and I have done both. I have, as a Norwegian politician, both cut but also increased Norwegian defense spending as a response to changes in the security environment. Then briefly on financial transparency, that is of great importance. We are constantly working on that. All nations are involved. Nations are directly involved in the development, screening, approval and monitoring of all of NATO's spending plans. And on the 4th of May, the North Atlantic Council approved a new set of NATO financial regulations, and the new set of financial regulations govern the financial administration of all NATO bodies, and the aim is to provide even more transparency and involve nations even more, because that is key for the involvement of nations. And when we ask for more funds, we have to be transparent. Then very briefly, you mentioned the cooperation between France and UK. And in general, I welcome cooperation between NATO allies, because I think that can increase the effectiveness and the way we utilize the funds which we allocate to defense. And we have to spend more, but we also have to spend better. And in the speech I gave on Friday, I addressed also the need to do something with the fragmented European defense industry, because the European defense industry is very fragmented, and that adds costs to defense investments in Europe. I had some examples, and as far as I remember, it is like in the United States, they have one armored infantry fighting vehicle, one type. But of course, they have many of them. In Europe, we have 19 different. In the United States, they have three different types of three different types of naval frigates. In Europe, we have 29. So of course, this adds a lot to the costs of Europe and defense spending in Europe. So we need more cooperation to reduce costs and get more out of the investments we make in our armed forces. Then Øyvind from Norway on Russia in Syria and how we respond, and all the turmoil in Syria. Well, we are responding in many different ways. First, we have increased NATO presence in Turkey. Turkey being the NATO ally, bordering Syria and Iraq, bordering all the turmoil in Iraq and Syria. We have assurance measures. We have AWACS surveillance flights. We have more port visits of NATO ships. And we have also Spain and Italy. They have deployed missile batteries, augmented Turkish air defenses with Patriot batteries and with something called SAMP-T batteries in Turkey. I would like to see more assurance measures from NATO to Turkey as a response to all the instability. And actually, there are some gaps which are not filled. We made the decisions to increase our presence in Turkey. We have implemented some of the measures, but we still have a way to go. So again, I urge you to go back to your capitals and ask whether your nation can do more to fill those gaps. All NATO allies support the U.S. coalition or the counter-ISIL coalition fighting terrorism and ISIL in Syria. And of course, we have increased our situation awareness. We are increasing our maritime presence in the Mediterranean with Sea Guardian. And this is also partly a response to the increased presence of Russia in the area. Then Georgia. Georgia is a very close partner. We have increased NATO's presence in Georgia. We are helping with reforms. We are helping with building security operations. And we have also established the new joint training center. I inaugurated that, I think it was last year. We have the whole North Atlantic Council visited Georgia recently. And I'm very much looking forward to attend the NATO Parliamentary Assembly in Georgia next year. I think it is in May. That's just yet another example of how we are working closer together with Georgia as a very close partner. Thank you.
Our next group of three will begin with Han of Netherlands, Iva of the EU will follow, and then Siavush of Azerbaijan. Beginning with Han.
Thank you, Mr. President. Thank you, Mr. Stoltenberg. My question and my remarks are directed at both the Secretary General as well as to our President. Mr. Stoltenberg, you said that this political body, this assembly that we have now together here in Istanbul, is the political platform for discussion and political views, also differentiating views. And you reminded us, you said, it's a sober reminder that we've seen here with the failed coup attempt, a reminder to all of us how easily democracy can be lost. And I agree with you. Our delegation agrees with you. But from that respect, I think from both the speeches of the President and the Secretary General, we have missed a reminder also to what is happening since the coup. We've all expressed our solidarity with the Turks, the population that was brave enough to take to the streets. We've all expressed our solidarity to members of parliament that are now incarcerated. But I think that that was lacking from both of your speeches. No reference to any of those elements. Democracy also requires a little bit of spine and backbone if you want to stand firm for the values that we all share. We can express our solidarity over and over again, and we have done so extensively. My country, immediately after the coup, all the way up yesterday, putting flowers to the great municipality of Istanbul. But it's also time now that we express our concern for 10 elected members of parliament that are in jail or in house arrest on unclear charges. There's more journalists in jail in this country than in China. Newspapers are being closed almost on a daily basis, and 100,000 people were put either out of jobs, and many of them are in jail as well. We cannot have free speech muzzled, free press being tied, and think that we can still defend the free world. Our delegation regrets very much that from both speeches of the Secretary General and our President, those references were lacking, and I would like them to give the floor or the opportunity to do that right now.
Before we go on to the... Before we go on to the next speakers, I do want to respond, Han. I don't expect you to have total recall of my comments, which, of course, I have in front of me in writing. And as you, at least others, will recall, I specifically called out the issues of the concerns that we voiced in all of our hearings concerning the emergency measures, specifically stated our concerns of judicial processes, and specifically stated our concerns that judicial proceedings be based upon public and clear evidentiary findings, and that these were the statements of all of our delegates in all of our hearings and meetings, and that they were also the issues that we challenged the foreign minister, the chief of staff of defense, and also the minister of justice. So I wouldn't want a mischaracterization of my comments to go without an answer, and I certainly hope that the rest of you recall that I addressed Mr. Erdogan directly when I raised those issues of concern from our body, because I would not want him to have been misunderstanding that our welcome did not come with concerns.
Okay. I'm very happy to give you the opportunity to reiterate that then.
I will then turn to Iva of... Iva of the EU.
Thank you. Secretary General, both NATO and EU are confronted with many very real common security challenges. Not only the war zones that are close to our allies' borders, but also threats that have no borders. Blind terrorist attacks, uncontrolled migration and trafficking, refugee crisis, and even cyber attacks. We have indeed to work closer together and control and defend our borders, our people, our democratic values, and as you well mentioned, freedom of speech. I would like to mention that you point out correctly that stronger EU makes a stronger NATO, now more than ever, and thank you for your efforts to work closer with our EU High Representative Mogherini for that. I would also be interested in hearing what is your evaluation of our existing common active operations, and what are the new concrete actions that you might have been planning and developing, notably in the fields of countering hybrid threats, coordinated exercises, cyber and capacity building of our partners, and more specifically, if you could, in the Mediterranean Sea and Syria. Thank you.
Siavush Azerbaijan.
Sayın General Sekreter, Ben Türkçe konuşacağım. O zaman isterim ki siz tercümeye kulak asasınız. Teşekkür ederim sizin çok güzel geniş məruzayla alaqadar çıxışlarını ve suallara cevap vermeye. Bir şey çok önemlidir ki, bugün burada Rusiyanı işgalçılıqda biz ittiham edirik. Ama ondan önce Ermənistan Azerbaycan'ın 20% arazisini işgal edildi. Ermənistan da işgalçı bir dövlətdir. Ve böyle bir olur ki, işgalçılığın fərqi var mı? Hansı necədir, hansı formadadır? Eğer o işgalçıdırsa, bu da işgalçıdır. İşgalçıya qiymət vermək lazımdır. İkinci bir tərəfdən Suriye ile bağlı qeyd etdiniz. Bugün Suriyada olan bütün teröristler işgal olunmuş Azerbaycan ərazilərini Ermənistan tərəfindən gətirib yerleştirilirlər. Ve Ermənistanın o terror hərəkatları, onların terrorizmə dəstək verməsi bütün cəmiyyətə bəllidir və bugün də burada iştirakçılar da dünən də bunun şahidi oldular. Növbəti bir sualım mənim sizə var. Ermənistan Rusiya ilə bağlı bircə ordu yaradır. Amma həmçinin də NATO Parlament Assambleyasında iştirak edir. Hansı mövqeni seçməlisiniz siz? Əgər bu işğalçı bir dövlət Rusiya ilə bir yerdə bir ordu yaradırsa, ve NATO Parlament Assambleyasında da gelip burada oturup ve size sual verir, iştirak edir. Buna necə baxırsınız? Ukrayna'nın ərazi bütövlüyünün ve Gürcistan'ın ərazi bütövlüyünün əleyhinə səs veribdir Ermənistan. Ermənistan qonşuluq siyasetinden danışdı. Hansı qonşusuyla münasibəti var? Türkiye'nin ərazisinə ərazi iddiası var, Gürcistan'ın ərazisinə ərazi iddiası var, Azərbaycan da 20% ərazisini işğal edibdir. Onda bu hansı ölkə ilə münasibət qurmağa çalışır? Mən hesab edirəm ki, bu suallara
karşı edirəm. Mr. Secretary General.
Thank you again. First, on the question from Mr. Hahn, the Netherlands. Well, as you stated and as I stated in my speech, the coup attempt in July was a very dangerous and serious attack on democratic institutions in Turkey. They were defended by the people of Turkey, but also by politicians, by members of parliament from all parties. And as I said in my speech, I visited the National Assembly, the parliament of Turkey in September, and it made a lasting impression on me to see the damage on the National Assembly caused by the bombing of F-16 during the night of the coup attempt. And of course, we from NATO and I expressed my solidarity with the people of Turkey defending their democratic institutions in July against the coup. And Turkey has the right to prosecute those who are behind those responsible for the failed coup attempt. I have stated in meetings that, of course, here in Ankara earlier, that that this has to be done in accordance with the rule of law. And when I met with the leadership in Turkey during my visit in September, they assured me that that would be the case, and they also told me that they would establish close cooperation with the Council of Europe. Because the Council of Europe is the body in Europe which is responsible for the Convention on Human Rights. And I welcome the cooperation and the contact that has been established between the Council of Europe and Turkey in the aftermath of the failed coup. So working with the Council of Europe to ensure that the rule of law is implemented in accordance with the convention is something I think is important and something I welcome.
And I have spoken several times with the Secretary General of the Council of Europe. I spoke with him yesterday, and he confirmed that they are in close contact with Turkey, working with them and addressing how the process after the coup attempt can be conducted in a way which is in accordance with the rule of law and which is in accordance with the European Convention on Human Rights. So I would like to see this cooperation continuing, because I think that's an important tool to address the importance of the rule of law and human rights in the wake of the failed coup attempt. And I will continue to stay in contact with the Council of Europe on these issues. In my speech, I also underlined that I personally attach great importance to the core values of NATO, which are democracy, rule of law, and individual liberty. And since the Council of Europe is responsible for the Convention on Human Rights, I think that's a good platform for addressing exactly those issues, and I welcome the cooperation between Turkey and the Council of Europe on these issues. Then Eva, on cooperation with the European Union. As you raised many different issues, but let me just briefly underline that, yes, stronger Europe is good for NATO. 22 European Union members are also members of NATO. And, of course, stronger defense in these countries will contribute to stronger NATO. At the same time, I have underlined it again and again that, of course, it is important how this is done, because we should avoid a situation where we see that there are investments in parallel structures or competing structures, for instance, command structures, which are competing with NATO. That will be unnecessary duplication. And therefore, I welcome very much that it has been clearly stated from the EU that this is not about building command structures which are competing with the NATO command structures. And that will be, in a way, meaningless, because then we will start to compete with ourselves. Because since 22 NATO allies are also EU members, competition between NATO and the European Union is absolutely unnecessary, because that will be to compete with ourselves. And second, this is not about building a European army, and this is not about EU starting to do collective defense. But based on this, and also based on that this is, done in a transparent and in an inclusive way with non-EU allies, I welcome. And this has been clearly stated from EU, and I also welcome the very close cooperation between my staff and the staff of the European Union and Federica Mogherini, and the personal involvement I and Mogherini have together, and also the cooperation I have with the Presidents Tusk and Juncker on exactly these issues. So I'm confident that we can do this in a good way for EU, for Europe, and for NATO, and that's what we are working on now. And that will be on many different issues, but including on hybrid threats, cyber. We are increasing our presence in the Central Mediterranean, so we will start to also support the Operation Sophia and so on. And High Representative Federica Mogherini and I, we will present a long list of concrete proposals by December, both to the European Union and to NATO, so we can agree on a practical way to expand our cooperation. This cooperation will be based on the principles which are long time established for NATO-EU cooperation. It will not change anything about related to the integrity and the autonomy of NATO and the European Union, and it will be in full respect of non-EU allies. And coming from Norway, which is a non-EU ally, of course I attach great importance to that we respect also the interests of those NATO members that are not members of the European Union. Then on Armenia and Azerbaijan,
I have stated clearly that NATO do not play a role in the negotiations aiming at solving the Nagorno-Karabakh conflict. We are supporting the efforts in the OSCE framework, the Minsk group, to address this conflict. We take interest in this process and encourage all sides to continue their efforts to aim at a peaceful resolution of the conflict. Peaceful resolution of conflicts is a core value for NATO, and it's one of the core commitments that all partner countries commit to when joining the PFP, and NATO will continue to support the Minsk group process. NATO-Armenia relations and NATO-Azerbaijan relations should not be conditioned on the Nagorno-Karabakh issue. So this is the NATO position, and then we will continue to support the efforts to find a solution within the OSCE framework.
Our next series of questioners will begin with Lorenzo from Italy, Omar from Israel, and then Osman from Turkey. We'll begin with Lorenzo.
Grazie, Presidente. Signor Segretario Generale, uno dei problemi dove il nostro Paese è impegnato maggiormente negli ultimi anni è il dover far fronte alla crisi dei rifugiati e le operazioni di soccorso nel Mediterraneo. Quest'anno soccorreremo 170.000 persone, ci sono più di 5.000 morti comunque nel nostro mare Mediterraneo. La nostra Marina Militare e la nostra Guardia Costiera sono impegnate in questo ambito, anche esprimo il nostro apprezzamento per anche le operazioni di supporto alle operazioni dell'Unione Europea con la missione Sea Guardian. Da un paio di mesi abbiamo inviato 300 militari per allestire un ospedale da campo in Libia per fornire assistenza medica alle forze libiche. È evidente che un punto fondamentale è il consolidamento del nuovo governo libico. Ci sono posizioni un po' diverse di alcuni paesi a tal proposito. È altresì importante che la NATO, a mio avviso, diventi anche un attore in questa direzione per assicurare l'unitarietà del governo libico e sostenere quindi il processo di consolidamento del governo libico. Le chiedo cosa intende fare nei prossimi mesi per assicurare l'unitarietà e dare maggiore supporto al nuovo governo libico. Grazie.
Omar of Israel.
Secretary General, you talked about the importance of deterrence and the measures NATO is taking. I have two questions. First, we are experiencing the brutal expansion of Daesh in the Middle East. Daesh took hold on large areas in Iraq and Syria, but endangers additional regimes in moderate countries such as Lebanon and Jordan. Does NATO take such potential threats into consideration to assist such countries if needed? The second question, we are experiencing as well the acceleration increase of Russian presence in Syria, among others, building air and marine Russian bases there. Apart from strengthening the presence of NATO in Turkey, which you already mentioned, is NATO considering, in order to deter Russia, to strengthen its presence in Lebanon and Jordan? Thank you.
Osman of Turkey.
Teşekkür ederim Başkan, Sayın Genel Sekreter. NATO Genel Kurulu'nun İstanbul'a yapılmasından dolayı büyük mutluluk duyduğumuzu ifade etmek istiyorum. Sayın Genel Sekreter'in Eylül ayında Ankara'ya gelerek, meclisimizi ziyaret ederek 15 Temmuz'da yapılan darbe girişimiyle ilgili istişarelerde bulunması sebebiyle de kendisine teşekkür ediyorum. Tüm siyasi partilerle mecliste görüşmeleri gerçekleştirdi. Ben de kendisine eşlik etmiştim. Bu noktada NATO'nun terörle mücadelede ülkemize verdiği destekten dolayı teşekkür ediyorum. Benim değerlendirmem Hollandalı Hollanda heyetinin başkanının tutuklu milletvekilleriyle ilgili değerlendirmesine bir açıklama yapmak istiyorum. Milletvekillerinin görevi mecliste kanun yapmak, halka hizmet etmektir. Bu milletvekilinin görevi teröristlere yardım etmek değildir. Teröristlerin propagandasını yapmak değildir. Onlara silah taşımak değildir. Onları ayaklanmaya davet etmek değildir. Hiçbir parlamenter kanunun üzerinde değildir. Anayasa, burada yapılanların hepsi anayasa ve hukuk çerçevesinde yapılmaktadır. Hiçbir parlamenter kendi ülkesinde biz bu kanunları tanımıyoruz. Biz bu savcılara ifade vermeyiz. Biz bu mahkemenin kararını kabul etmeyiz diyemez. Eğer bunlar sizin ülkenizde gerçekleşse bu milletvekilleri için neler değerlendirirsiniz? Hiç kimse ülkenin kanunları üzerinde değildir. Hiçbir parlamenter kanunun üzerinde değildir. Şu anda ifade vermek için çağrılmış başta ana muhalefet partisi genel başkanı olmak üzere Sayın Kılıçdaroğlu, Sayın Bahçeli ve diğer milletvekilleri gidip ifade vermişlerdir. Bu milletvekilleri bu ülkenin kanunlarını tanımadıklarını ifade etmişlerdir. O yüzden kanunun çerçevesinde gerekli yargılanmaya, gerekli değerlendirmeye ile karşı karşıya gelecekler. Milletvekilinin görevi seçildiği halka hizmet etmektir. Halkı ayaklanmaya çağırmak değildir. Terörizm propagandası yapmak değildir. O yüzden bunları dosyalarını iyi bilmek lazım. Konuşmadan önce dosyalarını incelemek lazım. Neyle suçlandıklarını bilmek lazım. İfade verilip bırakılan arkadaşlar da var. Dolayısıyla bu durumu böyle değerlendirmek lazım. Sizin ülkenizde sizin insanlarınızı öldüren teröristlerin cenazesine bir milletvekili gittiği zaman siz ne yaparsınız? Halkın tepkisi nasıl olur? Bunu anlamanız gerekiyor. 15 Temmuz darbe girişiminden sonra yapılan bütün işlemler kanun çerçevesindedir. Buradaki değerlendirmelerde şunu gördük. Biz sizin eleştirilerinizi dinledik ve onlarla ilgili olarak da ilgili bakanlarımıza, meclisimize gerekli istişareleri yapacağız. Your teşekkür ediyorum.
Mr. Secretary General.
Thank you so much. First, to Lorenzo from Italy, who asked about the refugee crisis. And first of all, I think we all have to remember that this is really a profound humanitarian tragedy, and people lose their lives trying to cross the Mediterranean, and we have seen a record high number of people losing their lives this year. So I think we have to remember that this is an ongoing tragedy. The response to this tragedy requires a wide range of measures, and of course NATO do not possess all the tools. Many of them are about economic tools, diplomatic tools, political tools. So this is a responsibility for the whole international community, and especially of course the countries in Europe which are most affected. But NATO is working together with other international organizations, especially the European Union, in addressing the refugee crisis in different ways. First of all, we help to address the root causes. And when NATO is so focused on what we call projecting stability, to stabilize countries in our neighborhood, that is also important for addressing the root causes of the refugee and migrant crisis. So our presence in Afghanistan is a way to address root causes, to help stabilize Afghanistan. But for instance, when we work with other countries in the Mediterranean region and the Middle East, that is also about addressing the root causes. So For instance, when we work with Iraq, a partner nation, in fighting ISIL, training Iraqi officers, that's also one of many ways to try to stabilize the region, and thereby also reducing the number of people that are forced to flee their country. We have increased our presence in the Mediterranean. We have our presence in the Aegean Sea, which I think has been a successful contribution to cutting the lines of illegal migration. We have seen the numbers of illegal crossings of the Aegean has gone dramatically down, and NATO is playing a key role providing practical support to the Greek and the Turkish Coast Guard and Frontex. And now we are also deploying assets, capabilities to the Central Mediterranean in support of the EU Operation Sophia. So I believe that we can do more, but we are already stepping up our efforts in different fields related to the migrant and refugee crisis. Then Omar from Israel, we are not doing much in Lebanon, but we are very present in Jordan. Jordan is one of our close partners. We support Jordan in different ways through our partnership with them. We help build defense institutions. We train. We have defense capacity building measures. And the whole idea is that Jordan is a kind of island of stability in a sea of instability. And I strongly believe it is important to support Jordan now and prevent Jordan also experiencing more difficulties. So prevention is much better than intervention. And that's the reason why I think it's important in general to support countries in North Africa and the Middle East, which are stable, to prevent them moving into more dangerous waters and become instable or unstable states themselves. So we will continue to work with Jordan, and Jordan is also contributing to different NATO operations and missions. And we are also working in fighting terrorism and Daesh in many different ways by supporting the efforts of the counter-ISIL coalition and by building local capacity, training local forces in different countries in the region, because I believe that's the most efficient tool in the fight against extremism and terrorism. Then Osman from Turkey. Well, as you said, we met in September, and you made it possible for me to visit the parliament. And as I've already stated, that has made a lasting impression on me to see the damage caused by the failed coup, the bombing and the shelling of the parliament, and also saw damage on other government buildings. And that was a stark reminder of how serious this failed coup attempt was. But I would also like to underline that it was during that visit in September that you informed me, and the Turkish leadership informed me, that they are establishing, and they have established, a cooperation with the Council of Europe addressing the issue of rule of law and the European Convention on Human Rights. And I welcome that, and I have been in contact with Torbjørn Jagland, the Secretary General of the Council of Europe. And he has assured me that they are working closely with the Turkey on these issues, and I think that is of great importance. Thank you.
We're coming to an end, so we're going to ask that each of the next questioners limit their time to 1 minute so that Secretary General can be on schedule. The first questioner will be Mike from the UK, Mohammed from Algeria, and Rob from the United States. Mike.
Thank you, Mr. President. My question relates to Russia and the way in which Russia is exploiting the internal divisions both between our member states and also interfering in our internal election processes. What measures is NATO collectively going to take to deal with cyber warfare and the way in which Russia is exploiting technologies and new ways of undermining us? And in that context, isn't it time we also made absolutely clear that Article 5 is a serious commitment and that all our political leaders on both sides of the Atlantic should understand what Article 5 means?
Mohammed, Algeria.
Monsieur le secrétaire général, la stratégie de l'OTAN pour combattre Daesh en Libye, quelles sont les dispositions que doit prendre l'OTAN pour protéger aussi les pays voisins de la Libye et maintenir la paix? Merci.
Rob, the United States.
Thank you very much. First of all, I would like to say to our colleague, Mr. Turner, thank you for your term as president, for what you have done for this assembly. We're very proud of your efforts on our behalf. And for the Secretary General, thank you for what you are doing for NATO. We're very proud of the efforts that you are putting forward there. I think everyone here is aware that there is a very real concern in the United States, including our Congress, about the strength and durability of European allies' contribution to these particular efforts. Mr. Secretary General, as you know, the U.S. is continuing to enhance its commitments to deterrence in Europe, chiefly through the European Reassurance Initiative. We are well aware of the very important European contributions thus far, but I would just like to underscore the importance that these continue and become stronger as time goes on, especially given the differing viewpoints of the threat posed by Russia. Mr. Secretary General, how confident are you in the sustainability of unified deterrence efforts over the long term?
Secretary General.
Let me start with the last question, and I am very confident, because we have seen again and again that NATO is able to adapt. For 40 years, NATO was focused on collective defense during the Cold War, from 1949 to the fall of the Berlin Wall in 89. Our main task was to counter, to balance, and to respond to the Soviet Union and the Warsaw Pact. And then, after the end of the Cold War, people started to ask, do we need NATO anymore? Is there any relevance of an alliance which was established to respond to the Soviet Union and the Warsaw Pact after the end of the Soviet Union and the Warsaw Pact? And we saw that NATO was able to adapt and to respond to a very different world. And we saw the importance of project stability beyond our borders, and we started to do that in the Balkans, help to end the war in Bosnia-Herzegovina, and also to stop the atrocities against people in Kosovo. And then we went into Afghanistan, and we have played a key role in managing crisis and projecting stability in our neighborhood. Then, after 2014 and the Russian aggression against Ukraine, we have adapted again. And now we do both collective defense in Europe, and we manage crisis and project stability beyond our borders, and we do both tasks at the same time. And we have also proven that, well, we have a long way to go when it comes to defense spending, but after years of decline, we have turned a corner and started to increase as a response to a changed and more demanding security environment. So I am quite optimistic when it comes to NATO's ability to adapt, because we have been able to do that again and again throughout history in response to a changing security environment. When the world changes, NATO is changing. And there are differences, there are different views. We represent different nations, different cultures, different political traditions. But again and again and again, we have proven that we are able to come together and agree on what matters for NATO, and that is our will and our commitment to defend each other, and that's great to see. And I very much welcome the very strong statement also from President-elect Donald Trump that he will be committed to European security and to NATO and to Article 5. As I stated many times, my responsibility is then to make sure that those allies who are not investing enough in defense
step up and do that, and I have already stated how much importance I attach to that issue. So I am optimistic NATO will continue to deliver deterrence and defense and collective defense. Then Algeria, what NATO does to stabilize the neighbors of Libya. Well, first of all, we have some very close allies, partners in the region. We have something called the Mediterranean Dialogue, where we have partners throughout North Africa, including Algiers and Tunisia. And we are working especially close with Tunisia. We have started different programs there to help them improve their special operation forces. We have helped them to develop intelligence services. And we also work with the other countries in the region to help them strengthen their defense capabilities. And we will continue to work with them both in a political dialogue, but also as part of defense capacity building efforts with many countries in the region. So we are focused on what we can do and NATO allies can do to stabilize and to support neighbors of Libya. Then Mike asked me about Russia and Russia's interference in NATO allied countries. We have seen increased presence of Russia in many different ways in different NATO allied countries. We have seen them conducting propaganda, and we are aware of that. We see it. And my answer is that our response to propaganda is not propaganda, but our response to propaganda is facts, because we believe that in the long run, the truth will prevail. So we are increasing our cooperation. We are increasing our work when it comes to strategic communications. That's a NATO responsibility, but of course, most of all, it is a responsibility for the different NATO allied countries to counter and to take part in debate and discussions, countering false accusations and statements from Russia and Russia-inspired institutions and organizations. But we should always very clear on the message that we believe that open democratic societies are more resilient, are able to resist propaganda from other countries. We should never limit the scope and the room for open democratic debate, because that is actually the key to our resilience, and that's one of the core values we are defending. On cyber, we have seen several NATO allies reporting about cyber attacks. And for instance, the United States have stated clearly that they deem that this is, or assess that this is, that Russia is behind. And we take this very seriously. Again, the first responder is the different nations. But NATO is helping to improve our cyber defenses. We are doing that in many different ways. We are developing the cooperation. We have made a decision at the Warsaw Summit to have a cyber defense pledge, which is a roadmap, different concrete measures to strengthen the cyber defenses. And NATO is, of course, focused on how we can defend our own cyber networks, but also how we can help nations which are under a cyber attack to defend their networks and their systems. Of course, so we have teams which are ready to be deployed on short notice to help respond to cyber attacks. Cyber attacks is something we take very seriously. We decided also at the Warsaw Summit to establish cyber as a domain in line with air, sea, land, and cyber, because this is something which we have to understand is an integrated part of almost any conflict now and in the future. Thank you.
Mr. Secretary General, I want to thank you for taking our questions. Our time with you has come to a close. We appreciate your making yourself available to the Assembly and your close work and your work in NATO to strengthen all of our security. Thank you. Once again, I want to thank the Secretary General for his work with the Parliamentary Assembly. In his statements, his embracing, of course, the role of our dialogue is incredibly important. Next on our agenda, I have the pleasure of welcoming to our Assembly Christine Mutinen, who is President of the OSCE Parliamentary Assembly. I want to congratulate her on her election in the annual session in Georgia in July. You've stated it as your mission to expand your Assembly's relations with the outside world, and of course that is the spirit in which you are here today. We're delighted to have you with us, and I give you the floor.
Thank you, Mr. President. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for this lively discussion we just had. It was very interesting to listen to you and to your arguments. And indeed, as you pointed out, looking around the transatlantic and surrounding region, it seems there is quite a number of hotspots in this area. Already, as the Roman poet Horace once said, it is your concern when your neighbor's wall is on fire. I believe we must take this inspiration from this ancient lesson as we address the modern challenges. At times, it is tempting to think that we will be secure behind a wall. We must, however, take into account the interests of other states and populations if we want to have long-term stability. Through both of our organizations, we strive to create security and stability in our neighborhood, knowing that serious challenges can only be managed successfully throughout cooperation. The idea of collective security and responsibility is clearly at the heart of the principles of NATO, but also of the OSCE. The OSCE's comprehensive approach to security includes political, military, economic and environmental, as well as humanitarian aspects. By addressing this wide range of security-related concerns on an equal level, whether they be human rights and democratization or arms control and confidence-building measures, the OSCE strives for inclusive and long-term security. Although our two organizations differ, we have a shared desire for security and for the improvement of the lives of our populations. For that reason, I'm particularly pleased to be able to speak with you here today with the parliamentarians of the NATO Parliamentary Assembly today to continue our common work to improve the lives of our constituents. As parliamentarians, we always keep in mind that it is our citizens who will suffer most if we are unable to find solutions to the pressing security challenges facing our region. But in today's world, no country can ensure its security on its own. Instead, we must promote dialogue and search for common ground. This is particularly important at the moment, with tense rhetoric increasing, and the critical voices of de-escalation and compromise seemingly more and more absent. We are expected to deliver security and stability, and we must be the voice of de-escalation. This is how to effectively address issues such as radicalization, terrorism, the challenge of mass immigration and refugee flows, or even climate change. Unfortunately, we are not there yet. Hand in hand with the increase of the tense rhetoric, there is an increased concern about the erosion of existing safeguards against the growing militarization of international politics. This includes the danger of a new arms race when we should in the end strive for arms control or even how to come back to talk about disarmament. Long-standing fundamental principles that underpin relations between OSCE countries are clearly being violated. The occupation and even annexation of a part of a sovereign state by another, holding non-democratic elections, an attempted military coup and severe human rights abuses are but a few examples of the challenges we continue to face. I would like to highlight the migration crisis, however, as one part, one area where our collective response could have been much better. So far, we have not succeeded in fully reconciling the rights of migrants and refugees for safety and humane treatment with the interests of security and stability. I'm afraid we have not lived up to our own high standards and values. As we seek to improve our response, we also have to dedicate increased attention to the underlying causes of migration. Issues such like poverty, political repression, violent conflict, or climate change all require our focus. As you can hear, there are many fires in our neighborhood that require our collective attention. It is essential that we all acknowledge that a security architecture that does not work for all of us does in fact not work for any of us. This is why we must exploit every opportunity to maximize the great potential of interparliamentary dialogue and interparliamentary diplomacy, and the shared ability of our organizations to address security challenges. We have seen the fruits of our cooperation in recent months, such as in our excellent cooperation in observing Georgia's elections. The OSCE and NATO assemblies stood side by side in making an honest and fair assessment of Georgia's elections. At a time when trust in existing political institutions and norms is being undermined, it is more important than ever that we work together to strengthen democracy. This is the true cornerstone of collective security. However, ensuring that elections are free and fair is just one of the ways by which democracy must be safeguarded. Here in Turkey, as discussed before, only a few months ago we witnessed an attempt coup that was one of the clearest attacks on democracy in modern times. And I see some colleagues here who were with me when we visited Parliament as well. And it was deeply troubling to see the rubble left by bombs dropped on the Turkish Parliament when we led a small delegation to Turkey already in August. This attempted coup underlines the critical importance of strengthening democratic institutions so that they can stand up to all anti-democratic attacks. In this regard, I also share concerns raised by my colleagues in the OSCPA about some of the recent developments here in Turkey, including the arrests of elected members of parliament, on grounds which some of us still strive to understand. It is precisely at difficult times that we must focus on open dialogue and robust engagement by a pluralistic parliament. On this topic and others, we in the OSCPA have engaged in a constructive dialogue with the Turkish authorities, asking them to maintain human rights safeguards also during the state of emergency. And I look forward to continued cooperation and discussions on how we can support and uphold democracy for the benefit of the Turkish people. Colleagues,
colleagues, as we seek to answer the question of how to ensure the security and prosperity of those who we represent, we must remain focused on the principles that are at the heart of our organizations. Principles are easy to maintain in good times, but are actually needed in hard times, such as those we seem to face now. Principled approaches are needed for long-term stability, for a Europe and a world that is more secure. But we can find hope and we can find inspiration in the history of our two organizations. NATO, which was founded in the ashes of the Second World War, and OSCE, which was created at the height of the Cold War. Both have contributed immensely to security over the recent years. We must continue this work, and the OSCE Parliamentary Assembly and I personally remain committed to cooperative work and dialogue. This is how we parliamentarians can help our neighbors with their challenges and create greater security also for our own family. Ladies and gentlemen, I wish you every success and hope for a continuous good cooperation with the Parliamentary Assembly of the NATO. Thank you very much.
Ms. Muttinen, thank you for your remarks and thank you for being with us. We're going to next take up the item of our draft budget. The budget for 2017, I'm going to ask Mark, our treasurer, to please come forward and introduce the budget.
Dear Mr. President, distinguished colleagues, you will be very happy to hear that I can be very brief. The only finance point we have on today's agenda is the draft budget of 2017. Yesterday afternoon, the Standing Committee has already approved this draft budget, and it's now before you, before this plenary for final adoption. You have heard me say on numerous occasions that for the last 6 years, the Assembly's budget has not kept pace with inflation. In other words, our budget of 2016 was almost exactly the same in numbers of euros as the budget of 2010. However, as I mentioned already last year in Stavanger, there is no further scope for such economies, and I'm therefore asking you to adopt this draft budget with a slight increase of less than inflation. The increases are only related to the three following budget articles: salaries, Chapter 1, Article 1, security, Chapter 2, Article 3, and interpretation costs, Chapter 4, Article 10. Salaries, as far as salaries are concerned, you know that under our financial regulation, the Assembly is obliged to increase salaries by the health index. This is a reference used for Belgian civil servants. But this only relates to reference salaries and leaves no room for any merit-based increments. In addition, Chapter 1, Article 1 of our budget includes not just salaries, but also allowances. And we know already that changes are in prospect that will necessitate additional spending under this article in 2017. Security. The security budget has to be augmented as the NATO PA has subscribed to a service providing specialized travel advice and assistance in challenging locations. This is upon the recommendation of the NATO Office of Security. And finally, interpretation. The last increase is in the interpretation budget. The current allocated amount does not reflect the actual yearly expenditure. In fact, a further increase in the future is likely to be necessary. As a result of these increases, I'm proposing an overall budget increase of 1.79%, which I should mention is lower than the current rate of inflation, which is 1.81. So I hope that you will all agree with my proposal and therefore adopt this 2017 draft draft a budget. As always, the International Secretariat and I are, of course, at your disposal to respond to any comments and questions you might have. I would like to thank, therefore, the International Secretariat, particularly Sebastian Botella, who is the head of operational management. And I want also thank our president, Mike Turner, for the excellent cooperation I had as a treasurer with you as a president during the last 2 years in the Bureau of this Assembly. So thank you very much. Thank you for listening to me. And if you have questions, please don't be afraid to ask.
Well, thank you, Mark, and thank you for your excellent job. First question is from Lord Campbell.
I have two questions, if I may. The first is, could you tell... Well, I want to begin by congratulating the Treasurer yet again, not least, not simply for this year's budget, but, of course, for the extended period over which he has managed the finances of the Assembly with great care and with great success. But I want to ask him, what is the amount currently held in the reserves for the Assembly? And my attention has been given to a sentence in the description, the narrative of the accounts, which says additional expenditures will be necessary, mainly for security reasons, both for the headquarters and for personnel or missions. I hope we can recognize that given that the Assembly headquarters is based in Brussels, and given that events in Europe in recent time have put civilians and others at risk, that the expenditure... I'm pausing so you can get a translation of what I'm saying.
It's okay. It's not about translation. It's about hearing you.
Very good. Yeah. Well... we should recognize that expenditure on security is not a luxury, but an absolute necessity, particularly having regard to recent events in Belgium, and of course the fact that the location of our headquarters, although in a very important and historic area of Brussels, nonetheless makes the headquarters extremely vulnerable. So I hope we can accept, and I hope you will give us an assurance, that nothing will be omitted by way of security if that is thought to be necessary.
Thank you very much, dear friend, for these interesting questions, and which allows me to make some interesting comments. We have invested a lot the last 2 years in security, and especially in security of the building of the Secretariat, which is located in Brussels at the Petit Sablon, which we all know. We have not only have changed all the entrances, but especially we had new windows, bulletproofed windows, in the ground floor, and because we have a lot of members of our staff working on the ground floor, and therefore we invested all that money. This year, in the 2017 budget, the increase in security is mostly due to a collaboration with SOS International, which gives our staff training how to behave in a location where there could be a crisis and how to check a location before having a conference. And I think this is very useful too. And this was recommended by the NATO Security Office. As far as our provisions are concerned, the reserves, remember well, that was your first question. These are around 600,000 euros. And we need them in case one country wouldn't pay in time its contribution. Sometimes this has happened. We needed to go into these provisions to assure the current expenses, but then later we put the money back in it. But that's more or less the amount, 645,000, I think. But I can check it up, and I'll come and give you the exact amount.
Thank you.
Any other questions or comments concerning the budget? Seeing none, then we will proceed to a vote. Please locate your voting cards. All those who are in favor, please vote in the affirmative. Excellent. Thank you. All those opposed? Let the record reflect that no one voted in opposition to Mark's credit. Thank you, Mark.
Thank you very much. Merci beaucoup.
Colleagues, we have now come to our break for lunch. We will suspend the assembly and will resume promptly at 2:00.